Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Late Night Radio with Freeman Jack. We'll be taking you into the late hours. Way, way into the late hours. And bending your mind.
You have meddled with the primal forces of nature, Mr. Beal, and I won't have it! Is that clear? Is that clear? You think you merely stopped a business deal? That is not the case!
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening, good night, good morning. Yes, 1 a.m. Saturday a.m. GMT. What a ridiculous hour to be beginning a broadcast. I'd like to thank the 25 of you in the chat for staying with us this week. It's certainly an encouraging increase from last week. I appreciate that the holiday season was upon us last week, so perhaps Saturday evenings are a bit more... Saturday mornings, Friday evenings were perhaps a little busier, so maybe we'll see the numbers starting to creep up. This show being scheduled at this hour really was only ever intended as a live feeder for a podcast schedule, and I'll be hoping to assemble a library of material resource that you'll be able to browse through at your leisure and at your own sort of on your own time. And that's really, I reiterate from last week, anybody that missed the first show last week has got the podcast. The first live Omniversity show was last week. We had Googleplex, the first global synthetic mind, where we looked deeply into the subject of computing and specifically the internet. And moreover, its release into the wild and some of the extraordinary circumstances around that. Certainly worth going and listening to. I'm also starting a return to my own broadcasts, not of an Omniversity nature. I find the format of the Omniversity rather constricting with my usual style. Anybody that knows me from the old days will know that I'm very loose. And I find the Omniversity, by its very nature, very demanding, very constrained. And its subjects have to be, obviously, out of necessity, be delivered in a very tight and concise and detailed manner. And that doesn't really suit my usual attitude. So, what's the subject tonight? Well, tonight, to delight and enthral you, can you teach an old dog new tricks? Question mark. Neuroplasticity. As uniquely, so kindly trailered for me earlier, can you teach an old dog new tricks? Neuroplasticity. The human brain has been proven to be a dynamic system of positive and negative reinforcements, which literally rewire and reprogram our brains on a structural level. We have the capacity to take command over this process and affect it directly and intentionally. Okay, so that's the premise, is that essentially we are given that our brains are kind of cast in stone by the time we are around 7 years old, and that from that point onwards it's merely a process of erosion, not any sort of increase. However, that presumption has been shown to be, broadly speaking, false. And tonight I hope to be able to bring you the mechanisms through which that plasticity, that neuroplasticity, is arrived at, and how precisely to take charge of that plasticity and to drive it yourself. And this is very simple stuff. It sounds very complicated, but it's simply a matter of... intellectual processes and practices. Okay, so let's cover human automata first. We have an autonomic nervous system. This is our nervous system that is largely largely concerned with regulating things like pulse and blood pressure and breathing. But it also does other things. It tends to regulate things like locomotion. When we walk, we don't think about each step that we take. That's second nature, it would normally be called. But I would like to put it to you that the automata is actually a very good analogy for what humans are more of the time than not. Automata is a word taken from the word automaton, which was a mechanical doll from the Renaissance onwards. These were sort of party tricks of the very wealthy, and their makers became incredibly famous, and some of them incredibly wealthy, if their automaton was credible enough and believable enough. Now, most of these automatons were simple mechanical clockwork models, just simply with such a hugely complex clockwork mechanism that they could carry out some incredibly lifelike acts. There's an amazing automaton swan made out of individual leaves of silver for virtually every feather on things' sort of neck and back and wings. And when this thing moves, it looks incredibly like a live swan in its motions. I mean, it's getting a bit sort of rickety, being sort of 300 years old or whatever it is now, and it can't be run very often, but you can understand how these things would have captivated the audiences of their day. Now, that's the basic automata. That's the automata that simply runs a pre-programmed mechanical program of actions. So once it reaches the end of its pre-programmed sequence, it will simply start again at the beginning and run exactly the same sequence in exactly the same way. Now, that was one type of automaton. There was a second type of automaton, and this was a programmable automaton, a variable program automaton. There was one in particular that was a small boy at a writing desk, and with this small boy at a writing desk, there was a way of inputting text characters so that the handwriting that the boy would write onto the page, which was written in an incredibly human manner, apart from the fact that the page moved under his hand rather than his hand moving over the page. But however, the movement of the fingers and the likes was incredibly realistic. But that this automaton writing boy would write the name of whoever you programmed in behind the model. And what I would like to suggest to the listeners is that as humans, we spend an awful lot of our time in an automated mode. And some of that automation is like the mechanistic repeating models. And other parts of that automation comes from a external programming, precisely like the boy that did the writing, the handwriting. I'm sure that if I was Lee, I would be trying to convince you now that it was the Borg trying to put this in your head. But quite frankly, it's everybody that puts this program in your head. Everybody and everything that you experience throughout your life programs your automated behavior. And broadly speaking, we run these subroutines, these automated subroutines, on a daily basis without ever even noticing that that's what we're doing. We go and boil the kettle, we run the tap, we drive the car, and most of these things we do with very little actual focus or attention on the matter in hand. Some of this is down to things like muscle memory and learned behaviour through practice. Some of it's very much more sort of directly attributable to physical structures within the body. And I'm going to be bringing you quite a bit of material tonight from Dr. Jordan Peterson, who's certainly, to my mind, one of the most most voluminous speakers on the internet on the subject of psychology, psychiatry, and specifically on neuropathology, which is, I think, possibly his particular field of speciality. And what I'd like to present to you is that it is possible to break out of those automated behaviours. And when we realise that we are largely an automaton running subroutines, and we begin to observe ourselves, we begin to observe our own thoughts, we begin to observe our own actions as a, I would suggest, a disinterested third party, or perhaps an interested third party, in our own lives, that in fact this is the squaring of intelligence, that when intelligence begins to study itself, it's multiplied by itself. So I'm bringing to you tonight literally the way of multiplying the volume or the amount, the metric of your capacity of thought by itself. So that's an exponential. And in order to do this, I'm going to have to present a scenario based around what I like to call the keeper of the gates. There have been a lot of famous psychiatrists that have subdivided the various groupings of mind and brain into various sort of subdivisions. And while we have sort of one brain, one mind, one self in the broader sense, the mind certainly can be clearly delineated. I think Jung did it best with his ego, superego, and id. And there'll be the context of mind that I will be referring to tonight. And I believe that Jordan Peterson is also a Jungian, so at least we're sort of on the same page there. Actually, I'm a Reichian, but that's a different story entirely. I won't go there tonight, just simply because most people will have absolutely no idea who William Reich is, or just his incredible importance to the treatment of psychiatric disorders. So, the keeper of the gates. I would suggest that the keeper of the gates would be Jung's superego. Essentially, the ego is the living mind, the persona, the front man of the mind. This front man is very brash. Front man or woman is very brash and is the thing that takes us out into the world. It's a very outward going complex of the mind, very inquisitive. It also keeps a tab of sort of regulatory processes, things like days of the week, times of the day, when we last ate, I mean, those sort of things. Remembering our name is all sort of components of the ego. And we tend to experience our self-persona, the thing that we think of as our mind, the thing that we think of as ourselves, as purely an ego. It has been my experience that this is a very narrow view of the mind. And in fact, in certain key moments, especially in incredibly heightened stress moments, certainly in things like car accidents, I've actually experienced the splitting of the mind and of entering the superego and of entering the realm of the keeper of the gates, of the overarching mind, I like to think of it as the watchful parent in the brain, the thing that stops us from saying the wrong thing. You could think of it as your conscience. And we rarely ever hear it speak and almost never see its actions. And I would suggest that in the moments of extreme stress where we appear to develop sort of irrationally refined motor skills and things that effectively save our life, that it's not the ego mind that's driving the body at that moment. In fact, on one particular occasion, I remember being particularly aware of having jumped into the rear seat of the car and was sort of crying for my life until after the moment of the accident, when I then re-entered my body and realised that I'd been at the wheel the whole time and wondered who on earth it had been driving the car, when I realised it had been me all along. Very peculiar experience. excuse me. So let's discuss a bit of basic sort of brain mechanics, sort of basic neural networks, the things that make up a brain. Effectively, the brain isn't just the bit in your head. The brain and the central nervous system are like the roots, the crown and trunk of a tree, and the roots of that tree. So you can think of the brain as being the tree above the ground, and the nervous system as being the network of roots going down into the body to retrieve data. The brain is a evolved structure, and it's layered. So we have a core structure that is, I think it's the prelimbic structures are essentially the reptilian and bird avian parts of the brain. So you could take the interior of a human brain and would find comparative structures mapped over onto both avian and reptilian brains, even on some fish brains. And essentially, as the layers of the brain go out, so we see the overgrowth of the mass, brain mass, over these core structures. When we get out to the outer peripheries of the brain, the brain's subdivided into three primary structures: the right hemisphere, the left hemisphere, and the frontal cortex. These are literally separate structures. If you were to see an atomized brain, you would see that these can be quite easily sort of peeled apart, and there are large clefts in between. These structures are connected by large nerve bundles. The one between the left and right brain, I think, is known as the corpus callosum. And within these kind of separate components, what we can see is from the nerve endings, the external expression of the central nervous system at the periphery of our body, at our fingers, our toes, and our skin, going to some of our organs, we see an axon. We have something called a synapse. And the easiest way to envisage a synapse is to look at your hand. The incoming signal path would be your forearm and your wrist, and the fingers would be the outgoing switched parts of the synapse. And this is essentially like the switches, the on-off switches inside the CPU of your computer processor. So these synapses are effectively the processing functional part of the brain that deal with electrical signals and prioritize them according to various mapping strategies. Okay, so we have the autonomic system, which is the unconscious system, the breathing and heart rate and the likes. Again, autonomic is a bit of a misnomer, because certainly anybody that's practiced any sort of meditation techniques or even just simply focused on their biological functions will find that a large number of these supposedly fully automated circuits, like our breathing and our heart rate, are actually directly under our intellectual control, should we choose to take control of them. I'm certainly pretty expert in moderating the rate of my own heart, and with a very small number of sort of meditation breaths, I can bring my heart rate from a racing pound down to sort of a reasonable sort of normal pace, or even lower it if I've got a fractious baby in my arms or something. And I know that with small children, their mood is often directly attributed to their carer's heart rate. And so by consciously slowing your breathing and slowing your heart rate, a fractious child can often just literally just turn placid in your arms. Something I learned at a very early age. And on the other side of it, we have the somatic or the conscious system, of which I've already broadly covered the three parts of the conscious and the subconscious mind, with the ego, the superego, and the id being the subconscious or unconscious mind. This is where sort of recessed memories and things like that spring from. But it's subconscious. It's something that we're not aware of. So anything that we are aware of with our intellects, with our personas, with ourselves, will be coming from the other two parts of the mind. But that isn't to ignore the function of the subconscious mind. It plays into part of the comparative structures, which we'll be covering later. Now, the way that the synapses work is through chemicals known as neurotransmitters. These are essentially a chemical electrical converter that takes an incredibly tiny electrical signal coming into the synaptic head and converts it from electro activity into a chemical release of an equivalent strength. Some of these neurotransmitters you'll probably be familiar with the names of. They're adrenaline, serotonin, and dopamine. Adrenaline is largely responsible for controlling things like heart rate and activity levels. Serotonin for regulating brain function, and dopamine is part of the reward structure, things like why you get a rush of pleasure when you drink a cup of tea when you're very thirsty or whatever, just like I'm about to. And these neurotransmitters, especially serotonin, I think serotonin is the primary neurotransmitter between the synaptic head and the receivers, the receptors on the synapse. And so it's key for transmitting nerve signals actually across each of the synapses, and for amplifying those signals as well. This is the other part that these chemicals play, that they take the very small input signal and they amplify it so that it can be sent down the next nerve path, down the next axon. Okay, I think we're at Peterson is virtually impossible. The man is just a towering mind, and whatever he says is key, important, and salient. And most of the sort of 15 or 20 minute recordings that you will hear will have been decanted out from an hour or 2 hours or 3 hours of his recordings. So not without some difficulty, I bring you Professor Jordan Peterson. This is, I need to actually pull the, let me just pull that up on screen, just so I can get the proper name for the, right, Maps of Meaning, that's it, what this is from. So if you go to YouTube and, type in Maps of Meaning for, narrative and neuropathology, and mythology. And this is a short edit from that piece. I'll be carrying another edit from that same piece a little later in the show. But this is to clearly outline this process of how the human brain grows in according to very predetermined structural confines. So, Dr. Jordan Peterson.
So there's lots of different ways of dividing up the brain, and believe me, people are still arguing about how to do that. Swanson is a developmental neuroanatomist, and he basically envisions the brain using a conceptual schema that's based on how it transforms itself across time. So, and what I really love about Swanson is that he builds the brain from the bottom up, from the body upwards. Okay, so, and that's incredibly useful because there's a real dualism that still saturates almost all of the conceptions that you hear about the brain in most areas, and psychology certainly being one of those. We kind of treat the brain as if it's the place of the mind, and the mind is something separate from the body, and you could just sort of take your brain out of your body and you'd still have a mind, and it's like, no, wrong. One of the things the AI people discovered after many decades of trying to make things intelligent was that until they put them in a body, things weren't intelligent. So intelligence seems integrally linked to the ability to maneuver yourself through space in a physically embodied, limited form, and to manipulate the world. So your body is, your brain is, first of all, your brain isn't in your head anyways. It's distributed throughout your body. All you have to do is look at the nervous system to figure that out. Second, there's more neurons in your autonomic nervous system than there are in your central nervous system. I mean, you know, your brain is not only in your head. It's a really foolish way of thinking about it. So, all right, having said that, there are multiple ways of conceptualizing the brain. And a lot of whether or not the conceptual structure is accurate is whether or not it's useful. So I'm going to go through a couple because they're useful in different ways. This is one that's basically based on the model that Russian neuropsychologists produced, led by Luria, who was the greatest Russian neuropsychologist and who had amazing students. And many of them laid down the groundwork for the models that we're going to describe. And they were heavily influenced by cybernetic thinking, by the way. So the two fields played like this over from the 1920s till now, really. So from the Lurian perspective, your brain is basically something that acts, it acts in the world and perceives the world. And the back half of the brain, roughly speaking, is for perceiving, and the front half is for acting. Now, here's something to think about. You know, I'm sure you've been taught the prefrontal cortex is the seat of abstract thought, you know, or the seat of executive decision-making, for example. It's like, I'm not so convinced about that theory for a variety of reasons, but one of the things that is true about the prefrontal cortex is that during the course of evolution, it grew out of the motor cortex. So if you look at this representation, the top one, there's the primary zone, which is the motor strip, and then the secondary zone, which is the premotor strip, and the tertiary zone, which is the prefrontal cortex. And basically what happened was that first animals learned how to act, and then they learned how to represent actions before they implemented them. So the purpose of thinking is to represent actions before you implement them. But it's not only actions, because there aren't only actions, right? Because to act, you also have to perceive. And so really what the prefrontal cortex does is run simulations of how a personality might operate, an embodied personality might operate in a fictional world. And that's what you're doing when you're thinking. It's also what you're doing when you're watching movies or reading fiction or any of those sorts of things, right? Instead of having to act something out and potentially dying as a consequence of it, you can watch something being simulated and see what happens. And then if the outcome is good, you can implement it. And if the outcome isn't good, then you can let it die. And so I think it was Alfred North Whitehead that said, the purpose of thought is so that we can let our hypotheses die instead of us. That's smart. That's a very smart thing. And so what's happened in some senses that human beings have gone from evolution to meta-evolution, right? Instead of evolving, we can model evolution and then implement the ideas, the personality, so to speak, that we think are most functional. And we let our fantasy do the selection instead of the actual world. Man, it's a brilliant solution. It's a brilliant solution. So in some sense, the sensory unit, which is the back half of the brain, is setting up your frameworks of perception and integrating them. And then the front half is determining how to sequence activities and modes of perception in order to act successfully in the world. Right? And so there's the actual implementation of the action, and then there's the modeling of the implementation, which is what gives rise to thinking. And I do think that it's very useful to think of thinking as a simulated personality, fundamentally. You're running avatars of yourself, in some sense, in your imagination, and trying to determine which ones are going to be successful. Now, you may have noticed, given that I used the word avatar, that we've also now figured out how to externalize the process of fantasy back into the actual world so that we can run simulations in fantasy on machinery, and we can play out potentials that way instead of only having to do it in our brain. You know, and it's... that's very, very smart. That's extraordinarily smart. And it's really going to change things. God only knows for how. So one of the things about Luria's model, you see that there's primary, secondary, and tertiary zones. The tertiary zones are zones of integration. The primary zones are zones where, especially in the sensory systems, where each sense is elaborated in its highest resolution sense before it becomes integrated with the other senses. And so the tertiary zones are actually areas of overlap between the senses. So for example, when you read silently, my experience of reading silently is I hear the words in my head, so to speak. Well, you might think, well, how, you know, you look at a word and you hear it in your head. How in the world is that possible? And the answer is, your eyes are using your auditory system. So there's overlap between the visual and the auditory system in the tertiary zones. And so basically what you're doing is hearing with your eyes. And, you know, your consciousness has this property of unification, right? It's sort of like a unified experience. And Luria believed that it was the tertiary zones that gave rise to that phenomena of unified experience. He's a very smart character. So the point is that the motor unit is basically utilized. The part of us that does planning and forward thinking is utilized to lay out simulated personalities in the world. That's a good way of thinking about it. So, okay, so that's one kind of neurological model. Now, let's see. I might want to go to more of the neurology here first. All right, so if you look at the motor strip, this is called a homunculus. And when Wilder Penfield was initially doing open, like, brain surgery on people with epilepsy, you know, you're generally conscious during brain surgery, which is a rather horrifying thing to contemplate because, you know, they don't want to cut out a part that you might need. And so they poke around in there often with electrodes and, you know, you can report what's happening to you. Well, what Penfield did was do electrode mapping of the manner in which your body was represented in the primary motor area that was responsible for sequencing action. And what he found was this. Now, usually you don't see it like that because the way your body is laid out on your brain, it's sort of torn apart and stretched out over the motor strip. And there's weird places where the parts come together. So, for example, there's a motor homunculus. And there's a sensory homunculus. And one of the weird characteristics of the sensory homunculus is that the genital region is right beside the region for the feet. And one of the things that you can infer from that is that's why people take such delight in such things as foot massages and why feet fetishes, for example, are quite common. Because the areas do bleed into one another. So that's pretty amusing. So anyways, there's the homunculus. And you might say, well, that's how your brain thinks of your body in terms of what you can do with your body. And so that's like a human being. That's, in fact, that might be more what a human being is like than the human being you see when you just look at a human being. And what you see is, well, we're pretty handy and we're pretty damn mouthy. And so one of the ways you can think about that, and I think it's right, is that human beings run around taking things apart and putting them back together with their hands, and then they talk about that all the time. And we have a tremendous amount of control over our tongue. That's wired up right at birth, by the way, and lips as well. So that's a primary investigative organ, you know, and it's used for multiple purposes. So, you know, children really explore the world with their lips and tongue. And, of course, it's a primary area for sexual exploration. But it's also the part of our body that we use to transform the things that we can do with our hands into patterns of communication so that we can speak about what we do with our hands so that other people can learn how to do that with their hands. And if you look at your hands, what you'll see is you're mostly thumbs, right? And, you know, one of the things that you always learn from scientists is that it's an opposable thumb that makes us human. And certainly the thumb, especially on the right hand, is like, you see, you've got more motor cortex devoted to your damn thumb than you do to your whole body. And that's because, well, try picking up a wrench with your back. You know, you're just not going to get very far. And so it's really useful to think about the brain body in this homuncular fashion because it also helps you understand other things because you'll hear people say, well, dolphins are superhuman in their intelligence because their encephalization quotient is higher than ours. And the encephalization quotient is the ratio of brain tissue to the ratio to body weight, fundamentally. Brain weight to body weight. Yeah, that's a measure of intelligence. But the thing is that imagine a dolphin homunculus. It's like, what the hell are they going to do with all that intelligence? Like, nose up some dirt on the bottom of the ocean? That's about it. They can't build anything. They can't take things apart and put them back together. And so whatever their brain is being used for, it has very little relationship to what our brain is being used for. Our bodies are articulated, where a dolphin is sort of like a test tube. You know, and they can swim like mad, and they're obviously extremely playful, which is one of the attributes of intelligent creatures. But they're not taking things apart and putting them back together like we are. And that's what we're doing all the time. We do that with our speeches. In fact, the essence of taking things apart and putting them back together. You know, and the hypothesis are with regards to speech development that we developed our capacity for articulated movement before we developed our capacity for language, and that the only reason we ever developed a capacity for language was because it sort of developed as a secondary consequence of our developed ability to produce articulated action. Now, the two things probably spiraled across time. So I don't think you can, you know, it's not a chicken came first and then the egg issue. It's that chickens have eggs and eggs have chickens, and that just keeps going. But the point is that our ability to represent things in an articulated manner is directly related to our ability to use our joints in an articulated manner. And so that's what we're like in the world. We're out there doing things to it and then talking about it. We're very handy and we're very mouthy. So that's useful to know, because that's sort of how the brain pictures the body. And the fact that the brain pictures the body that way means that that's how the brain conceptualizes the body as an entity for use in the environment. And so you say, well, how do human beings adapt? Well, we run around taking things apart and putting them back together with our hands and talking about it. And we're very good at that. And so you could say, well, in some sense, that's our primary... I think that that's... It's a reflection of the same processes that gave rise to the idea of the hero. Because there's two ways of adapting to the world, in some sense. One way is just to do what everyone else has done that's always worked. All animals do that. That's what they do. Like bears now and bears 1,000 years ago, it's like they're the same bear, even though they're very complicated. Same with chimps, you know. People say chimps have culture and can make tools. It's like, that's wrong. And here's why it's wrong. If a chimp could increase its domain of cultural expertise by 0.1% a generation, which is like nothing, well, run that for 7 million years at compound interest. And what happens? Well, you get Toronto, right? I mean, I don't know how much we transform our culture with each generation, but it doesn't have to be very damn much for there to be cities after 2 million years of iteration. Well, chimps are still living in the jungle. Now, they do use tools, but what seems to happen is that the environment, and they do use different tools in different locales, but what seems to happen is that the environment suggests the tools to them. So they have a certain level of intelligence, and they can figure out how to use what's at hand, and what's at hand is different in different places, so they use different tools. But that doesn't mean they're thinking up different tools. They're not, clearly, because there's no accumulation. There's no accumulation of culture, so I don't see how you can escape from that mathematical argument. And you can make the same argument to pretty much any other creature. You know, even ants. It's like they're making the same damn anthills they were making, well, God only knows how long ago. I mean, they're very successful at it, but there's no innovation. And so being the same as the things that lived before you that lived is a pretty good strategy. But that isn't the human strategy. Or it's actually half the human strategy. Because half our strategy is to do what everyone else has always done. And the other half is to fix that where it's not working very well, or at least to try to fix it. And I think this is an excellent representation of the abilities we have embodied to do precisely that. So here's another way of thinking about the brain. This is mostly partly from Luria, again, in the Russians. This is from one of his students whose name is L. Conan Goldberg, who's a practicing neuroscientist in New York, and I think he's a very bright guy, and I like his theory because, you know, you've heard classic theories about linguistic versus non-linguistic hemisphere, so the left hemisphere usually is regarded as the linguistic hemisphere because in right-handed males, in particular, language tends to be, you know, pretty located in the left hemisphere. Now, what I would say instead of that is that there are linguistic and non-linguistic systems in the brain, and most of the time, they segregate out so that the linguistic system is in the left hemisphere and the non-linguistic system is in the right hemisphere, but it doesn't have to happen that way. It can be reversed with people who are left-handed. It's more distributed in women. And if you lose your whole right hemisphere when you're like 18 months old, so you don't even have a right hemisphere, your left hemisphere will specialize so that it has a linguistic system and a non-linguistic system. Partly the way to think about that is that, you know, the top part of your brain, the cortical cap, you can kind of think about that as plurivalent territory. Lots of things could happen to it. And what happens is that as you develop, the underlying systems, the more biologically archaic systems, colonize the cortex. They fight, basically. So, you know, your ears and your eyes fight over which part of the back of the brain they're going to have access to. And usually the eyes win at the back part of the brain and the ears win more here. But, you know, if you don't have any eyes, the ears are going to colonize the visual systems. And that's partly why if you can't see, you can hear better. So, and even if you lose your hand, like if you lose your thumb when you're an adult, what will happen is the part of the motor cortex that represents your fingers will grow. It'll grow into that area so that these get, you have more brain now devoted towards these fingers. And if you're born without hands and use your feet, then the feet will start to develop a map that looks like the map of the hand. And there's some flexibility in that, even in adulthood. So there are these underlying systems that grow up, and you know they expand their capacity for differentiation and synthesis by occupying the cortex. And that can happen in a variety of ways, even though it tends to happen in a standard way during normal development. So you could say it's better for your eyes to invade the visual cortex because it's sort of set up for that. But if they can't invade the visual cortex and it invades the auditory cortex, that works like 90% as well. It's something like that. So the top cortical cap is somewhat specialized, but it's not specialized to the degree that it's lost its plasticity for the first stages of development. It's why child neuropsychology tends to be such a mess, is because the child's brain is so plastic that you can't really say with any certainty what any given part of it happens to be doing, except down in the, you know, in the ancient areas where some stability has been attained. So here's a way of conceptualizing the difference between the left and the right hemisphere. Although, again, I wouldn't think about it that way. Now, the classic distinction is linguistic, non-linguistic. Now, Goldberg puts that on his head. He says, no, linguistic, non-linguistic is an emergent property of a more fundamental division. The more fundamental division is between novelty and routine and anomaly. And that maps onto the sorts of discussions that we've been having. What do you have to deal with in the world? Things that work the way you think they will and that you want them to. And then things that don't. So you have a system that works with the things that work the way you want them to. And you have another system that deals with the things that don't. And roughly speaking, in the standard human brain, the right hemisphere seems to be wired for novelty detection, emotional response, and provisional processing. Whereas the left hemisphere seems to be specialized for routinized activities. And that would include representation in language. Now, what happens, for example, if you practice a novel task, is that when you first do it, it's very computationally demanding. And so you set out a lot of energy, and a lot of your brain is at work, especially in the right hemisphere. And as you practice it, the right hemisphere stops working and the left hemisphere works more and more. And then a big part of the left hemisphere works. And then as you keep practicing it, that moves back until there's a little tiny part of your brain that's really active when you're doing it and you're good at it. And so partly what happens is, imagine it this way, is your brain, when you're first trying to do something complex, it's maybe you're trying a new piano piece or maybe you're doing some improvisation. It's like you're trying out all sorts of things, right? A lot of it's error and error correction. It's a bloody mess. It's exhausting. You're doing all this and you're getting rid of that thing that doesn't work and that thing, and you repractice this part that's awkward. And as you do that, there are fewer and fewer errors, less variability, and more routinization. And as you're doing that, you're building a little machine at the back of your head that does this perfectly, but that really can't do anything else. Now, that's really an interesting thing to think about. Because what it implies is, whatever you practice, you build into your implicit processing systems. So be careful what you practice. Because once you get one of those little machines back there and it really knows what to do, it's there. Now, you could build another little machine that stops it from doing what it's doing. But it's pretty damn hard to get rid of that machine once you've built it. And so if you build a cocaine consuming and desiring machine in your head, that machine might end up being more powerful than you are, in which case you're basically ruined. And that's really what happens to people who are addicted, because they build expertise in cocaine seeking and preparation and ingestion, And it's really a powerful system because it gets hit by dopamine every time it's successful. So it grows into this like monstrous subpersonality. And all that you need to activate that subpersonality, even if it's been dormant for a long period of time, and you know you're out of the addiction, is the sight of something associated with cocaine. It's like, whoop, up it comes, and you're under the, that's the monkey on your back, so to speak. And so what happens when you're trying to get people unaddicted is that you can take them to a treatment center and let them go through all the minor league horrors of withdrawal, which are nowhere near as bad as people generally claim. So like heroin withdrawal is like a very bad flu for about 4 days. It's not exactly pleasant, but it's not like alcohol withdrawal, which just like kills you often. So you let the person get through all that. They're no longer dependent on the chemical, and they're fine as long as they're in the treatment center. But as soon as you put them back in their environment and they see like their friend Joe, who's like, you know, their drinking and cocaine partner, it's like poof, up comes the monster and they're gone. And it's very, very difficult to treat addictions. And that's because an addiction is not a psychological thing. It's like you built a real monster in your head, and the you're going to have to like bore it to death over years before it goes away. And so, and then if you're stressed, well, that's going to make it even more difficult for you to inhibit it. And well, it's a bloody mess. It's a mess. Or if you get money, which is like the worst thing that can happen to you if you're an addict, you know, it's like I've had addicts as clients, and the worst thing that ever happens to them is payday. It's like they're gone on payday for like 3 days. They're gone. And then they come back and they're all beat to death because they, you know, they've screwed up horribly and they're broke. And so then they're safe till the next time they get some money. So these are the sorts of associations that go along with the novelty versus routinization model of the brain. So it is right versus left roughly, but it's better to think of it the other way, novelty versus routinization. And so the novelty processing part of the brain is responsible for the production of negative emotion. Why? Well, when you run into something that you don't expect, you should immediately be cautious because something that you don't want might happen to you. Now, you can be excited because maybe something new will happen, but the prudent thing to do is to be on alert first, because God only knows.
Oh, I'd like to thank the 17 of you still left in the chat at this wee small hour of 2 a.m. And I'd like to also congratulate you on your hugely enlightened minds. I'm really encouraged by the level of discussion in the chat. Thank you so much. Really very encouraging. Not easy at this time of day, I can assure you. We just preambled the music there with Professor Jordan Peterson, giving you an outline of the mechanics of brain formation and its plasticity. And this is a key point, that the axons that connect the various synapses together are not a fixed, hardwired structure. The actual number of axons and the number of neurons may be relatively stable in an adult brain. However, I'm about to go on to describe how the process of engorging and erosion alters the structural properties of those various parts of the brain, and alters the way that our thoughts progress through our minds. So, I'm going to get onto the subject of neuro-linguistic programming and cognitive behavioural therapy as mechanisms that we can access this plasticity of mind that we can directly access. Oh, actually, before I go there, let me just stop there just to point out, throughout the Omniversity broadcasts, the music breaks will not be merely music breaks as ear fodder to make a gap and a chance for you to run off and flip the kettle on. I really sincerely hope that you stay for the music breaks and listen equally as carefully to the music that I play as to the words that I'm saying, because often they will be incredibly intentionally selected from my very vast music knowledge. and intended to augment the subject. We just had their David Byrne and Philip Glass from the album A Tree Is Best Measured When It's Down, The Civil Wars, Music from the Knee Plays, I think is the full title of the album. And we had social studies there. And I adore David Byrne's rather odd perspective on humanity. He's almost like a benign alien looking in on humanity with a rather bemused smirk on his lips, which I find particularly rewarding to listen to. He always has a very different take on just on the human organism. He really does take a zoom, a sort of wrong way down the telescope view of humanity. Anyway, back onto the subject. So listen carefully. I'm not just playing the music just for shits and giggles. So NLP and CBT, neuro-linguistic programming and cognitive behavioral therapy are the two most powerful tools for remapping your own intellect and your own brain and your own emotions. Now, while this may seem possibly preposterous idea, I can absolutely assure you that the evidence is in that cognitive behavioral therapy in a therapeutic environment helps 7 out of 10 patients who receive it. And I would suggest that the other 3 probably weren't doing it right. Okay, this is an incredibly powerful tool. And when allied with the concept of neuro-linguistic programming, now I would like to remove the construct of neuro-linguistic programming from any of the memes that you may have heard applied to it, whether they be hugely positive or hugely negative. I would suggest that neuro-linguistic programming is as entirely positive or negative as the person who is using it and what they are using it for. So your advertisers and your PR agencies will be deeply embedded within the neuro-linguistic programming movement. But that's not to say that NLP isn't an incredibly powerful tool that we can use for our own purposes, not to affect and influence other people's lives, but to affect and influence our own. Okay, so we need to cover hemisync, which was broadly touched upon in Professor Jordan Peterson's piece beforehand, where he described the natures of the two primary hemispheres, the right and left hemispheres, and how they're involved in emotion and linguistics. Well, it would appear that through the process of writing something down and then reading it aloud, that we engage that connection, that corpus collectum, between the two hemispheres, and engage this sort of comparative circuit that checks what's being said with what's already known. Well, if you've written something down and then you're reading it aloud, then what happens is the two parts of the brain that would normally be separately dealing with each of those properties of reality are suddenly concurring on every beat, that the very words that you are reading aloud are the very words that you wrote down. So of course they're going to tally. And this has an extraordinary property within the sort of the turbulent mind of the subject, and that what happens is that deeply buried thoughts, that often consciously buried, you know, I mean, unpleasant thoughts, things that you've tried not to think about, will be dragged kicking and screaming out of the recesses of your mind. And what tends to happen is that we'll push these repressed thoughts either into the logical or into the emotional sides of the mind, and smother them with either a coating of emotion or a coating of logic that we don't want to go anywhere near. The beauty of cognitive behavioural therapy, and certainly of the practice of writing one down one's life story or one's troubles or whatever the heck it is, and then reading it aloud, is that it often brings forth these unbidden, repressed memories, repressed thoughts, but it doesn't bring them forth in the manner in which we would be repressing them, the fearful thoughts that we thought that they were. It somehow contextualizes them, and it renders them within the context of their historical surroundings, something that's often absent, especially from sort of traumatic experiences and things like this that we really sort of dread going near, perhaps grievances and things like this, is often through the CBT practice of writing down and reading aloud that we replace something into its context by removing it from the sort of shadow self, from the repressed mind, and placing it back into the conscious mind. It appears to regain its context from the connection between the logical and the emotional components. And this can be incredibly curative. I mean, I can't impress on you how much. I'm not going to go too much into this now, because I fortunately covered this subject some 3 years back at some length. And although I didn't think that the audio was going to be particularly appropriate, when I reviewed it, it's incredibly potent and absolutely applicable. So for the last hour of this show, I'm actually going to be stepping back from the mic, but you shouldn't notice, and allowing a three-year-old recording of mine to run, and I'll be summing most of this up in there. Now, Professor Peterson there was talking about the comparison machine, and essentially this is the process through which our experiences are compared to our memories, our understandings, our paradigm, and our behavior is a resultant combination of those two effects. So our perceived reality is then compared to our sort of known map of reality, and as long as nothing alarming springs out or nothing novel springs out, then it's just automatically accepted without it needing to pass through the conscious mind at all. And so this is what drives the automaton. Now, if there's something in our lives that we're trying to overcome, if there's some difficulty or unpleasantness, some emotional state that we don't enjoy, this is entirely at our control. And that what you'll find is that that emotional state is the consequence of the engorging of one of these neural pathways, of one of these synapse and axon routings. And that by undertaking simple diversionary tactics to head off at the pass, by utilizing our gatekeeper of the mind to observe our own thoughts as a passage through our ego mind, and on seeing a known thought of ill consequence, we can put into place both intellectual and physical barriers into the normal transit of that thought into action, and replace it with our own thoughts and our own chosen actions, rather than some sort of pre-programmed automata. Just to add to this, a large part of neural network, neural mapping, is to do with skill acquisition. Professor Peterson there was saying about how various aspects of the physical body are directly mapped to various parts of a normal brain, and are then remapped if the brain is injured in some respect, and this carries on into adulthood. If you acquire a brain injury as an adult, while there are some areas of the brain, if they are damaged, they appear to be too far to be able to reacquire those skills, I can absolutely say without question that it is possible to essentially regrow an adult mind from a shattered mind. My very dearest friend was involved in an enormous car accident that basically threw her from 25 back to the age of 12. And she stayed there for a good long time. But through the determination of her physio and psychotherapists and through our determination as her dear friends, we, between us and through her own determination, restored her to absolute... You would not know that there'd ever been anything wrong with it. You have to be a very close friend of hers to ever notice that there was ever anything that had been untoward with her intellectual functioning. So, yeah, quite a remarkable recovery. And certainly was written off by the doctors. They had no expectation of her acquiring an adult intellect after such a serious brain injury. So we can acquire skills at any age. Something that struck me recently with my electrobiology stuff was that it may indeed simply be the amount of time, having been one of the first 3D gamers and having been as driven in my 3D gaming as I am in every other aspect of my life that I choose to pursue, that I spent far too many hours, frankly, flying in 3D simulators. Simulators were always my thing. Driving simulators, flying simulators, I didn't care as long as it simulated reality in an immersive enough environment that I could do things in the 3D environment that would quite literally be lethal to do in real life. And it suddenly occurred to me that through my flying of 3D combat simulators, in the flight simulators, that I'd in fact experienced probably vastly more combat hours than any World War One ace, and where they may have gone on to become supremely confident individuals through their experience of survival and have remarkable tales to tell, that the fact that they survived is another issue. That they're the ones that never actually had it get that bad. Well, when I was flying in 3D flight simulators, I would crash and die on a daily basis, if not an hourly basis. I've walked away from more fatal plane crashes in 3D simulations than is physically possible in a dozen or a hundred lifetimes. So even the experience of not having succeeded in your efforts to outfly your component, your opponent, or your combatant is an education. And what I would suggest is that the part of the brain responsible for 3D modelling, the skill of being able to imagine what's on the other side of an object when you can't see it, is in fact an area of the brain approximately the size of a postage stamp somewhere in the hippocampus. And that when the when a study was undertaken of London taxi drivers who had done the knowledge, it was found that their hippocampi, I suppose, had engorged and was up to 100 times the volume of an average person's hippocampus. And so the act of learning every street in the central London district and all of their various interconnects had actually forced that part of their brain to such a state of engorgement of the axons having become so fat and the bundles in between the synapses having become so copious that effectively the actual part of the brain was measurably increased. And this would be exactly the same part of the brain that 3D gaming environments would effectively deploy. Other than that, we've got constant achievement. So I think that it's important that, especially as we age, I mean, I'm now in my 50s and heading towards grey hair and ageing, but refuse to slow down, refuse to accept any impairment to my intellectual faculties and attempt to achieve more in each year by way of intellectual achievement and academic study than I'd done in the preceding year, and I think I'm doing a fairly good job of that so far. It's also a matter of balancing the domestic and the aesthetic. By this, I mean that we all have complex lives of both very domestic routines and the aesthetic, those ecstatic moments that we all feel from time to time. And it's incredibly important that we manage to find a balance between the two. If we find our lives becoming far too domestic, that this will be mapping our brains for domesticity. And it's incredibly important that we maintain our aesthetic lives with an equal vigour that we do follow our domestic lives. Not that we should forget our domestic lives. It's important that we eat and keep clean, etc. So they're the key points on, I think, on... I didn't really touch on neuro-linguistic program. Neuro-linguistic programming is simply the process of using language as a mechanism for changing these axon densities. And so things like affirmations, I don't hold with the whole law of attraction nonsense. A deeper understanding of holographic reality theory will certainly clear up any misunderstandings about that little scam. It is true that we create our own realities, and we create our own realities out of the language, out of the linguistic process. Quite how this is achieved isn't entirely clear, but through the process of affirmation, through the process of positive affirmation, through the process of eroding the language that your mind uses that is framed negatively, you can utterly convert the world as you experience it. Again, I'll go into this much deeper in the last hour of the show. I'm very sorry for any of you can't make it to that. Again, I direct you to the podcast page. Just simply look for Omniversity on the podcast list. I can't impress on you enough how life-changing some of these practices can be, and how some of them can be quite difficult to start with, or quite wearing to start with. But none of this is actually difficult or complicated. The practices are all very simple. It's really just a matter of mindfulness, becoming the observer of your own thoughts, becoming the third-party observer in your life. Not to say that you should separate yourself from your experience of your life. That's entirely not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that you should develop an additional mind to watch over the mind that you explore the world with. And it is entirely possible, and really not that difficult once you practice. Okay, I've got a bit more Professor Peterson lined up for you here. It's going deeper now into the subject of how the structures of mind are generated out of experience and practice.
Your ongoing behavior. It does, I would think about it as doing low resolution hypothesis generation. So, for example, if you're alone at night, say, and I don't know, maybe you've watched a horror movie, so you've got yourself nice and primed, and it's like 1 a.m. and you're tired and you haven't eaten anything for a while, and you hear some weird noise in a room upstairs, images are going to flash through your head. And they're basically hypotheses about what might be up there. And, you know, they can take bizarre form, like especially if you've been watching a horror movie, you know, God only knows what, so some serial killer with like a hockey mask up there or something. You know, but what your right hemisphere is doing is a very rapid, quick and dirty processing of what the horrible thing might be. And that you're on alert, and you need to kind of know what might be there. And so you overestimate, might be the worst thing you can imagine, and that'll freeze you like a rat. And if nothing else happens, then, well, maybe you'll hide under the bed, which, you know, might be a useful solution. Or probably you'll, like, walk upstairs and see what happens as you walk. And if nothing comes leaping out and killing you, then you'll think, well, it's at least not the sort of monster that leaps out and kills you when you're walking up the stairs in the dark. And so you're narrowing it. You're developing a higher and higher resolution model of the thing. Then, you know, you go upstairs and you find that, I don't know, maybe your cat knocked a stuffed animal onto the floor or something, you know, it narrows it down to irrelevancy. But your right hemisphere is going to be doing the initial quick and dirty processing. And those are low resolution representations. They're often archetypal. You know, it's like things that go bump in the night. Well, it's a big category. And you might think, well, is that a reasonable category? It's like, it's a reasonable category. Things in the night that might hurt you. It's the category of monsters, fundamentally. So, and you know, you might say, well, there's no such thing as monsters. Well, we already went through that with the little book, didn't we? So, of course there are. It's just a low-resolution category, you know. So, but that doesn't mean it isn't useful. Larger motor actions are associated with the part of the brain that does novelty processing. And again, that's kind of low resolution, right? Because when you really figure something out, you can fiddle around with it in detail. But if you're reacting in a quick and dirty manner, you're using your whole body. So, and on the routinization side of the equation, you've got positive emotion moving forward, because it's much more appropriate to move forward in fully articulated territory, because you know what you're doing. And so if you understand the territory and you've articulated it, then the probability that you're going to get what you want when you're there is going to be very high. Word processing, linear thinking, detail recognition, detail generation, fine motor action. The actual physiological structure of the left hemisphere is more differentiated than the physiological structure of the right hemisphere as well. And another way to think about it, I think, is that the novelty processing unit, which is non-linguistic, is actually under the control of the underlying limbic and hypothalamic systems. So it's bottom up. It's sort of the part of your brain that still acts like an animal acts. Whereas the linguistic part, that's sort of the you that you think of yourself as. That's where the, roughly speaking, the ego that's talking to itself resides. And I think it is capable of top-down control to a larger degree than the novelty processing unit, which is still working as a quick and dirty defense system and is highly motivated by more primordial systems. So, okay, so that's another way of thinking about it. We can zero it in a little bit more. There's been a lot of work on a brain area called the hippocampus, and the hippocampus is the part of the brain that moves information from short-term attention to long-term storage. It seems to do that across time. So, for example, if you suffer maybe impact-induced amnesia, a little bit of oxygen deprivation, the hippocampus was a very active part of the brain, and so it doesn't like being deprived of oxygen. And so if you have brain trauma and you get oxygen deprived, it'll damage the hippocampus. And then what often happens is you can't remember the accident. You can't remember what happened for 6 months before the accident. Your memory of the last 18 months is pretty hazy. But the farther back you go in time, the more likely you are to have access to the memories. So what seems to happen is the hippocampus seems to, it does a bunch of things. It moves, it probably organizes your autobiographical information initially, and then as it's elaborated in memory, it moves up into cortical representations and becomes more permanent. And maybe articulation has something to do with that. Like, I have a suspicion that partly what you're doing when you're doing the writing that you already did is you're moving information more and more permanently into cortical representation, cortical semantic representation. You're detaching it from its underlying emotional substrate. So the hippocampus seems to be responsible for that. So if you take people whose hippocampi, because there's two of them, have been destroyed, there are a few clinical case reports of people like that, they can't develop any new autobiographical memory. So the most famous of those patients was a guy named H.M., who had bilateral hippocampus damage, partly from surgery and partly from epilepsy, and he was stuck in like 1957 for 40 years. He couldn't even really recognize himself in a mirror because it was like the old him. And although he could learn new procedures quite well as a normal person, so he could learn a new procedure by practicing it day after day, but if you showed him the thing he'd learned, he'd say, I never saw that before, even though he got much better at it. And so he was one of the first cases that showed that memory systems were dissociable. So anyways, the hippocampus is a big deal. Now, the Russian neuropsychologists, Solokov and Vinogradova, followed by Jeffrey Gray, followed up on this cybernetic model via Luria, And they came up with the hypothesis that what the hippocampus was doing was comparing what you expected to happen in the world with what was happening. Okay, so it's an expectation-based model. The idea was, because they were behaviorists, the idea was there are stimuli in the world, they're actually there, you're monitoring them, you have a sense of what's going to happen, which is a cognitive expectation, and as long as the two things are co-occurring, then your emotions, particularly your threat response, is inhibited. So the threat system is sort of always on, but as long as everything is happening the way you expect it to happen, then it's inhibited. Now, the way it's inhibited, it seems to be, it's something like this. There's a part of the brain that's very deep called the reticular activating system. And the reticular activating system is an ascending stream of neuronal connections. And if you're in a car accident, you twist your head and you snap that tract, because it's actually fairly fragile, then you're unconscious forever, and that's that. So it's a very, very important tract, and it seems to be governing arousal. It's what governs your emergence into consciousness and your descent into unconsciousness at night. Very, very, very old brain system. And what it seems to happen is if the hippocampus detects a mismatch, it's tonically inhibiting the reticular activating system. So as long as everything is going according to expectation, the reticular activating system isn't sending a message to the amygdala and other systems that are primarily associated with emotion. It's not sending a signal to them saying, wake the hell up. But as soon as there's a mismatch, then the hippocampal inhibition of the reticular activating system declines, and the amygdala and other emotional systems, motivational systems as well, turn on. So, or are no longer inhibited, which is a better way of thinking about it. Okay, so now when Gray, who is also one of the cybernetic theorists, talks about what happens when you hit something that's unexpected, he basically says you have to revamp your motor programs and your expectations of the future in order to reconcile the error, and that's a complex process and it requires exploration. But the problem with that theory is you don't have access to the present. You have a model of the present. And you don't expect things to happen. You want them to happen. And so what that means is if they don't happen the way you want them to, you have a bigger problem than the cognitive cybernetic theorists originally envisioned. And the problem is the place where the error might be is way bigger. It might be in what you want. It might be in how you put together what you want with the other things you want. It might be how you put together all those things with what other people want. It might be something wrong with your conception of your abilities at the present time. It might be a skill deficit. And it might be something that's gone astray with your conceptualization of the future. That's a big search space. And so that's part of the reason. So you might say, well, what should you do when you hit something you don't expect? And the answer to that is you default to emergency preparation. Now, how much do you default? Well, we don't quite understand the representation yet because it's associated with this hierarchical problem we already described. So I think it's got to be something like this. Your brain must be able to tell somehow how much of its structure is dependent on the viability of a given node. So imagine that you have a representation, and hardly anything depends on that representation. And then that representation is disrupted. It's like, yeah, that's no big deal, because it's only knocking out a part of what you're using to orient yourself in the world. But if it's a fundamental presupposition, maybe like the continued presence of a loved one, on which all your other plans are predicated, because you can imagine that sort of as a neural structure, if it's way down at the bottom and the neural structure is branching off from that, and that gets disrupted, it looks like that the hippocampal septal system has some ability to sense the degree to which a given conceptualization is fundamental. And maybe that has something to do with how early in life it was laid down. You know, because you know that once you make a presupposition in childhood to orient yourself, then other more finely grained presuppositions are going to emerge from that. So maybe it has something to do with depth of representation in the brain, like, or the branching, or the count of the branches that come off that, I don't know, and I don't think anybody does. But there has to be an association of that sort. Yep. Well, I can tell you one thing that's been done about that. So this is the kind of science that people hate. You may or may not know that Ashkenazi Jews, European Jews, on average have an IQ that's about 15 points higher than the rest of the Caucasian population. And that's a lot. And that's part of the reason why they're massively overrepresented, for example, among people in most high-level occupations, but among Nobel Prize winners and so on. They're also much more prone to neural diseases that are associated with hypergrowth. So the fact that their brains are more plastic in some sense comes along with susceptibility to a variety of diseases of the nervous system. So there's an intelligence proliferation problem there. So your brain can be so plastic that it starts to become abnormal. So we also know, with regards to openness per se, that here's one of the best tests for openness. We could do this right now, but I don't think we will. But if I say, okay, take out a piece of paper and a pen and write down as many words as you can that begin with the letter S in 3 minutes, there's going to be a lot of variation. In this group, I would think it would be from 50 to 200. The people who can write down more words, they're higher in openness. They're more creative as well. And it's a pretty good predictor. So that isn't so much, I think, an indication necessarily of the complexity of the branches, but it's certainly an indication of how rapidly you can access the information that's in those branches. So that's how you maintain emotional stability. The way you maintain emotional stability is something like you have a conception of how the world should lay itself out when you act. As long as that conception and your model of what's happening match, then your hippocampus tells your reticular activating system to leave your motivational and emotional systems dormant. And then if there's a mismatch, it's like, it's time Stop. To wake the hell up.
God, I was miles away there. Fabulous Pixies with Where Is My Mind? How very appropriate. Actually, Sam and Kieran, who were asking in the chat, I'm sorry, I'm going to be an awful wind-up here, and I'm afraid I'm not going to cover non-local mind in this week's broadcast. I think it's more appropriate. It will be being covered incredibly fully in next week's show in the holographic reality, plastic reality, digital virtual reality show that I'll be broadcasting next week. I'm sorry if that's a bit of a wind up for you. I'm just aware of the time, and I've still got another 15 minutes of Jordan Peterson to squeeze in before playing a full hour of really detailed information on how this can be put into practice from, like I say, from a show of mine from 3 years ago. So I'm just going to rattle through just a little bit this last intermediary section here. Cognitive behavioural therapy for wellness. Psychic cleanliness is a key feature of an application of a cognitive behavioural approach to adjusting your own neural maps. And what I mean by psychic cleanliness is that you have to avoid anything that could be seen as a pollutant in the process. So anything that is carrying anybody else's intention, whether that be a conversation about bills or a soap opera on television. I personally, if I was going to begin the practice of CBT, the first thing that I would do would be to disconnect myself entirely from the mainstream media, at least for a short time. Just do a bit of cold turkey from the EastEnders and from the Hollyoaks. It'll do you good, believe me. It's also really important to be very careful of the company that you keep. Essentially, we are programmed by our peers as much as by our parents or our school or the government or the television. And so the company that we keep is also very key to the condition of our intellects. And while I wouldn't recommend that anybody just suddenly drops a friend because they consider them to be bad company and a psychic pollutant, that's really not what I'm suggesting here, but certainly at least for the period that you are exercising this muscle, which is a muscle that needs to be exercised, the constant gatekeeper of your own thoughts when you first begin it as a process is not an easy practice. It becomes second nature, just like driving a car. You know what I mean? Think of it as driving a car. This would be, you know what I mean, your first few weeks of entertaining cognitive behavioural adjustments to your intellect would be akin to your first weeks behind the wheel of a car when you were learning to drive. So just be very careful as to what times of the day you go on the road, I think is probably the best way that I can put it. Here's a last little piece of Jordan Peterson. I know that I'm really starting to run up against the time, and I don't want to be taking you people past 4 a.m. I just think that's just cruel and heartless. There's too many of you in the chat, I'm sure some of you must have lives to get up to in the morning. But this is just a lovely piece. I'm sure that some of you must have grown up with the story of I think it's Timmy and the Dragon or something, with the kid who finds a dragon in his bedroom in the morning. Well, Professor Peterson here takes that story and just completely explores how we create our realities from our perceptions, and carries that through into sort of neural mapping. So here's the last part of Professor Peterson.
So I'm going to tell you today about a way of looking at the world that I think is substantially different from the way that most people look at the world. And the way I want to tell you about looking at the world today is, I think, more inclusive than a standard sort of materialist view. Like, the standard scientific view of the world, of course, is that it's made up of familiar objects and that the world is, in essence, a material place. But there's some very potent limitations of that viewpoint, despite the fact that it's given us tremendous power. And the limitations are essentially as follows. The essential materialist view can't tell us anything about consciousness, which is probably the primary fact of experience. Neuroscientists in recent years, mostly in the last decade, have been trying to crack the problem of consciousness, and they have absolutely made no progress. They've tried to associate consciousness with neuronal activity, but that seems to be an incomplete answer, because there's many forms of neuronal activity in the brain that aren't accompanied by consciousness at all. Not only do neuroscientists understand virtually nothing about consciousness, they can't even really figure out what its function is. They can't understand why our brains would go to so much effort to make us aware of things when it isn't clear at all that awareness is necessary for life, especially given that there are many life forms on the planet that don't seem to be aware at all. The standard materialist view is also insufficient in many other ways. It's insufficient philosophically, I think, as you probably all know, because a conception that portrays the world as made up of objects is in some really fundamental way dead. Right? It doesn't seem to have a place in it for human beings, or a place in it for meaning, or a mode whereby you might be able to conceptualize the real existence of something like an emotion or a dream or a motivation, all phenomena which are just as mysterious to neuroscientists and to scientists in general as consciousness. Now, the problem with this seems to be mostly experiential. If you have to ask people what they know more than anything else, they know, number one, that they're conscious. They know, number two, that their internal experiential life is composed of emotions and motivational states, which, although not rational in essential structure, are so real and relevant that virtually everything that people do is predicated on them. So our current viewpoint, despite its ability to give us tremendous technological power, seems to eradicate from formal consideration many, many essential experiences that are vital to life, in fact, even perhaps primary. Now, I'm going to suggest to you today that there's an alternative viewpoint. And I think also it's one that, although you may be hearing about it formally for the first time, is also something that you know unbelievably deeply. How thousands of years ago, Plato proposed that all knowledge was remembering. And of course, we don't believe that today because we believe we gather knowledge as a consequence of contact with the world. But you'll see today that the knowledge that I'm going to share with you will strike a deep chord of remembering, and it's because everything that you've done throughout your life is in one way or another predicated on what I'm going to tell you today. I'm going to demonstrate this in a peculiar way, I think, because I'm going to start by telling you a story. And the reason I'm going to do that is because models of the world that include phenomena like consciousness and emotions and motivations and actions and interactions are generally portrayed formally in stories and not in scientific theories. And it does turn out to be that stories themselves have an identifiable structure, even a grammar that makes them comprehensible. Furthermore, it turns out that even the simplest stories, especially if they're elegantly constructed, have an unbelievably profound underlying meaning. And you can frequently see this most particularly in children's stories. So if you go to a video rental establishment, you'll find that in the top 10 highest grossing movies of all time are four Disney movies that are animated fairy tales, essentially retelling of mythological stories. They strike a deep chord. Why? I'm going to tell you a little story to begin this off with. It's a kid's story written for children of about 4 years of age, but it's very, very elegant. I tried to cut it down for this talk, but I found I couldn't because it was so well edited that every single piece of it had to fit in to make the story complete. And I'm going to show you first the structure of the story. Now, Billy Bixby was rather surprised when he woke up one morning and found a dragon in his room. It was a small dragon about the size of a kitten. The dragon wagged its tail happily when Billy patted its head. It's interesting, you know, in Chinese mythology, the dragon is a positive figure. In European mythology, the dragon is something to face in combat and destroy, or something to face in combat and build something out of the pieces left over from the dragon. Billy went downstairs to tell his mother. "There's no such thing as a dragon," said Billy's mother. And she said it like she meant it. There's a part of your brain that tracks threats, and it's not really all that smart in some ways. All it does is say, look, here's the problem. And it's waiting for the rest of your brain to conjure up some solution to that problem. And if it doesn't conjure up a solution, then it just presents the problem over and over and over and over and over. So people who have post-traumatic stress disorder, for example, who've been really upset by their contact with something unexpected, dream about the same tragedy forever until they solve it. And they solve it by facing it and living it over and over, voluntarily. So you see, Billy, he's pretty much got it right off the bat, right? The dragon wagged its tail happily when Billy patted its head. Billy went downstairs to tell his mother. "There's no such thing as a dragon," said Billy's mother, and she said it like she meant it. So there's a dragon in this house. Now, the next thing you might wonder is, how often have you actually gone into a house where there's a dragon? My guess is if you don't take this particularly specifically and allow yourself to use your imagination and to think metaphorically for a moment, you've all encountered dozens of houses that were filled right to the rafters with various dragons, all of which were being studiously ignored by the people who inhabited the house. Billy went back to his room and began to dress. The dragon came close to Billy in a friendly manner and wagged its tail, but Billy didn't pat it. If there's no such thing as something, it's silly to pat it on the head. Billy washed his face and hands and went down to breakfast. The dragon went along. It was bigger now, almost the size of a dog. Billy sat down at the table. The dragon sat down on the table. This sort of thing was not usually permitted, but there wasn't much Billy's mother could do about it. She'd already said there was no such thing as a dragon. And if there's no such thing, you can't tell it to get down off the table. Sometimes I sit with friends of mine who have very young children to eat, say. And the children, 2 or 3 years old, don't sit at the table, they sit on the table, or they run around the table, or they run around the table and pull things off the table, or they run around the house and pull things off all the shelves in the house and keep their parents so busy chasing them around that they have no time whatsoever to interact as adults. Well, you have to wonder under those circumstances whether you're dealing with a child or a dragon, so to speak. And you also might wonder whether or not the dragon is large and unruly, precisely because the parents are completely unwilling to admit that it actually exists. Mother made some pancakes for Billy. But the dragon ate them all. Mother made some more. But the dragon ate those too. Mother kept making pancakes until she ran out of batter. Billy only got one of them, but he said that's all he really wanted anyway. One time, I walked in the house, and the other four or five kids that we had in the house were off playing, and this little kid was standing in the corner, like really isolated and looking, you know, upset fundamentally. So I went over and I poked him a bunch, because generally, if you poke a kid a little bit, you know, well, they'll go like this, you know, they'll sort of back off. But sooner or later, you can crack them and they'll smile and then they'll play. Not this kid, boy, there's no bloody way he's going to play with me. And that was that. Like, he'd already learned that adults should either be ignored or that they were trouble. And he wasn't going to let any adult into his little world. So there was absolutely a dragon associated with that little boy, and it was eating all his pancakes. Billy went upstairs to brush his teeth. Mother started clearing the table. The dragon, who was quite as big as Mother by this time, made himself comfortable on the hall rug and went to sleep. I really like this one. By the time Billy came back downstairs, the dragon had grown so much he filled the hall. Billy had to go around by way of the living room to get to where his mother was. "I didn't know dragons grew so fast," said Billy. "There's no such thing as a dragon," said Mother firmly. Cleaning the downstairs took Mother all morning. What with the dragon in the way and having to climb in and out of windows to get from room to room. So, you know, you think back in your own experience when you've gone to a house where there's a dragon hiding underneath the living room rug and nobody's saying anything about it. And then you think, how long does it take to get something absolutely simple done in a house that's absolutely jammed to the rafters with unfinished business? Forever, right? Organizing people in a household like that to even do something as simple as go out for breakfast in the morning, or even perhaps to make a meal, is virtually impossible. Why? Well, because there's something going on in the household that has been studiously ignored for a very long time and has grown so large as a consequence that it occupies the whole domain. By noon, the dragon filled the house. Its head hung out the front door, its tail hung out the back door, and there wasn't a room in the house that didn't have some part of the dragon in it. When the dragon awoke from his nap, he was hungry. The bakery truck went by. The smell of fresh bread was more than the dragon could resist. He ran down the street after the bakery truck. The house went along, of course, like the shell on a snail. The mailman was just coming up the path with some mail for the Bixbys when their house rushed past him and headed down the street. He chased the Bixby's house for a few blocks, but he couldn't catch it. When Mr. Bixby came home for lunch, the first thing he noticed was that his house was gone. Luckily, one of the neighbors was able to tell him which way it went. You know, that sort of thing happens to people not infrequently too, right? They're not really looking around much at what's going on, and they come home from work one day, and their house is gone. And what does that mean? Well, maybe their children have become completely alienated from them, or maybe their wife has decided suddenly, but of course not so suddenly, to leave. Why? Well, according to this story, it's because something ignored was growing in the house. Mr. Bixby got in his car and went looking for the house. He studied all the houses as he drove along. Finally, he saw one that looked familiar. Billy and Mrs. Bixby were waving from an upstairs window. It means the same thing that's meant in the New Testament when you're told not to build your house on a foundation of sand, right? It doesn't matter how good the house is or how well constructed it is or how rich it is, if the foundation is made out of sand or if it rests on top of a dragon, there's nothing in that household that's ever going to be accomplished that's positive. And the wealth, the display that the house might consist of is nothing but a sham. Mr. Bixby climbed over the dragon's head onto the porch roof and through the upstairs window. How did this happen? Mr. Bixby asked. It was the dragon, said Billy. There's no such thing, Mother started to say. There is a dragon, Billy insisted, a very big dragon. And Billy patted the dragon on the head. The dragon wagged its tail happily. Then, even faster than it had grown, the dragon started getting smaller. Soon it was kitten size again. I don't mind dragons this size, said Mother. Why did it have to grow so big? I'm not sure, said Billy, but I think it just wanted to be noticed. So the first thing you might think about is just what happens if you don't pay a bill? Like really don't pay it, right? I mean, when it first comes in, it's only the size of a kitten. But if you leave it alone for 2 or 3 years, it pretty much grows into a full-fledged dragon. Why? Well, because things that you ignore have a life of their own, complex life, like a bill. A bill is attached to a whole industrial complex, right? One of whose major functions is to make sure that you pay the bill. And if you don't pay the bill, then you immediately find out what it's connected to. It's connected to something immense and very troublesome. And if you allow the full force of that thing to manifest itself, it's not pretty. So one lesson from this story is that if something's nagging at you just a bit, it's probably better to deal with it before it turns into a full-fledged dragon. And then you might think, well, what if it's already a full-fledged dragon, right? I mean, then what's your option? There's nothing left but to run away. And so then I can tell you what we know from 50 years of studying the outcome of clinical psychological interventions. So let's take an extreme case, right? Let's say something truly terrible has happened to you, and as a consequence of that, you're in shock, post-traumatic shock, which is a condition that's sufficiently serious to damage your brain over time. It's not only a psychological disorder, it's a physical disorder. If you're really stressed, your cortisol levels shoot up. And if your cortisol levels shoot up, that cortisol in high doses is a neurotoxin, starts to damage your brain. So let's take a very extreme case and imagine that you've been violently sexually assaulted, and as a consequence of that, you're in post-traumatic shock. How do you get cured? So that means you can't really go outside. You certainly can't encounter anything that's associated with the event. Your sense of integrity and personal safety has been completely destroyed. Is there any way you can get back on your feet? Now, there's a woman named Edna Foa in New York, I think one of the world's top clinical psychologists, and she's been dealing with women who have post-traumatic stress disorder for decades. And she's found a treatment that works. And the treatment is this. She has the women relive the event in as much detail as possible, over and over in their imagination, with the accompanying emotion. And she's found, because she's done physiological measurements on her clients, that those women that allow themselves to get the most fully upset as a consequence of the reliving get better faster and stay better longer. The clinical evidence is absolutely clear. When you take someone to therapy, you're basically doing two things to them. Well, three. You allow them to confess what's wrong with them, because it's really useful to actually say what it is that's bothering you. It makes it clear and distinct. You help the person get their story straight, because you have to have your story straight, right? You have to know where you're coming from, and you have to know where you're going, because otherwise there's no structure for your life. And the third thing is, if your path from point A to B is being blocked by something that you're afraid of, you better learn to confront it, because if you don't, it will grow and expand until it turns into the kind of dragon that occupies your whole house. Anything that stops us on the path that we've chosen produces negative emotion. That's how we're set up. And our emotional systems are actually quite straightforward. We posit a goal. The thing about people is that we can posit virtually anything as a goal. That's one of the things that distinguishes us from animals. So we can all be thrilled to death when our favorite soccer team scores a goal, because we participate in what they're doing, the same way we participate in watching a protagonist on a movie or in a book. We can feel it. We embody it. We even know now that the neural systems that I utilize to watch a movie involve the same neural systems that the actor is utilizing acting out the part. So when you say you understand someone else, what you mean is your body is set to do exactly the same thing their body is. And your emotional systems are locked on exactly the same way theirs are. So when they experience something and you're watching it, you experience an echo of it. And that's what understanding means. And it turns out as well that those neural systems that allow us to embody someone else and to imitate them are right underneath the structures that we've evolved to use for language. And what that indicates is that mostly what we use language for is to tell stories. To tell stories about the way that people act so that we can derive information, not about what the world's made of, because we don't really care about that in some fundamental way, but instead, how should we act? That's the fundamental question. How should we act?
Mental health issues are a spectrum. And essentially, we're all somewhere on that spectrum, that mental health issues include happiness. So in mental health issues, I mean, the emotional state of one's mind, the emotional capacity of one's mind, the capacity for rational thinking, the capacity for acting appropriately according to, life stimuli, isn't necessarily always about mental disease and mental disorder. That I feel that many of the descriptions of mental health disorders are in fact perfectly natural, appropriate responses to certain circumstances in life. After the death of a parent or a child, it's an entirely appropriate response to go into a period of mourning and to suffer a period of very low mood, of great grave introversion. And even, we lost our puppy recently, and not the one of the most poignant things was that where her sister, who we had with her as a littermate from a pup, witnessed her sister's death and was entirely with the family during that period, it was very interesting to watch not only the human family grieving for the loss of this dog, but also to see her dog family grieving. And Tubby, although she was also afflicted by the same disease that appeared to have killed her sister, was poorly at the time. She wasn't very poorly. And I would suggest that the majority of the change in her behaviour over the weeks that followed were an entirely natural version of what humans would suffer as depression. And yet I wouldn't necessarily go so far as to say that that she was depressed, more aggrieved, and her life had changed. Her expectations of daily life were now suddenly radically different, where going out for a wee in the morning used to be fun with her sister, now it's just having a wee. And this is my point, really, is that we all need time to adjust. That when traumatic things happen, when sudden changes happen in our lives, there'll always be a period of adjustment. And sometimes accompanying that period of adjustment may come a period of, how should we describe it, emotional instability, where we find that our normally steady moods are suddenly flying, where we'll go from the heights of ecstasy to the depths of tragedy on a moment-to-moment basis, and life becomes very much a roller coaster ride. And sometimes even nothing at all like that. Certainly with some of my bereavements that I've had with my family members, the main overwhelming sensation at the time has been one of complete numbness, of an incapacity to have any emotional connection with what has just happened. Gutted comes to mind. That's certainly a very powerful description of how we feel when our hopes, our dreams, our desires have been obstructed, frustrated by life. So I'm not just talking about bereavement or loss the split up of a relationship. These sort of things happen to us on a day-to-day basis. And what we have this kind of persistently happy model of what it should be like to be alive presented to us by the TV and by the radio So we have this expectation from society that we should have that plastered grin on our face at all times, and that everything should be enjoyable and should be fun. And you know, I mean, it's always been my feeling about a utopian world is that it would be a very damn boring place, and that this is one of the things that has struck me about the kind of roller coaster of my life, is that I would never have had the incredible highs that I've had unless I'd experienced the incredible lows that I'd had, and that these were part of a natural cycle of hard knocks of life are the learning tools, they're the education, you know what I mean, that's your life school A levels, if you like, and the ability to rise above those knocks is really your life school degree, you know what I mean, this is your pass in life schoolness, you know what I mean, if you can manage the knocks in life and to flow through them and to rise above them and to carry on, you know what I mean, carry on regardless, then that's, you know what I mean, that's really what the school of life is all about. And also, to an extent, I think this is where an awful lot of emotional health, mental health issues actually stem from, is that fear of going through those real troughs. And in my experience, this is a trap for the unwitting mind, that when we feel ourselves heading for a trough, we will backpedal, we will bail like mad to try and save ourselves from this hideous looming blackness in our lives, when in fact, if we were to embrace the fact that this was a purely natural cycle of emotional events, and to simply travel through that low point, it is very much like a roller coaster ride. If you don't get enough impetus on the downhill parts, there won't be enough to carry you through to the heights of the uphill parts. And this is very much the same with life, that it's almost a case of embracing whatever comes, good, bad or indifferent, and riding with it and making the most of it, that actually enables the passage of stuff through your life, you know what I mean, of life through your life, that any time that you try and prevent or sidestep a bad feeling, that essentially kind of locks that part of yourself into some kind of a repeated cycle of avoidance, and that in fact, if you kind of embrace that darkness and absorb it and examine it objectively, you know what I mean, with indifference, examine your own grief as a third party observer, examine your own grief as if you were a friend looking over the shoulder of an upset loved one, you know what I mean, consider yourself to be the observed rather than the observer, and suddenly the mind's perspective is zoomed out by an extra factor, and suddenly we become the observer of our life's works rather than the doer of them. And in this kind of elevated mental state, we can study our actions and often learn an awful lot more from our behaviour than simply by being in that behaviour. If we simply dwell within our behaviour and never examine it as an impartial observer, then we simply are automata, we're robots. And that's really what I want to get onto tonight, is just the incredible power of some of the modern talking therapy psychiatric tools like CBT, cognitive behavioural therapy, and the ability for somebody with a reasonable level, a reasonable grasp of kind of logical deduction, to be able to overcome most, if not all, mental and emotional difficulties by understanding the nature of, it's known as hemisync, when the left and right brains are connected where previously they were disconnected, and this is a purely intellectual exercise. There's also synaptic remapping, which is an important part of CBT, cognitive behavioural therapy, where a physical, I've got my level so low, I must be whispering, guys. Terribly sorry about that. I'll just turn this at home. But yeah, where essentially the actions of the physical body are mapped and mimicked by the synapses of the brain, and that by taking conscious, like a conscious planning role, like a planning official, council planning official, planning some new road layout. We can quite literally plan and remap our own brains. Right, okay, the incredible power of the principles of cognitive behavioural therapy to change how you think and feel. And now this isn't like some kind of NLP weirdness where anybody else will be imposing how you should think or feel on you. The beauty of CBT and hemi-syncing in general is that what actually happens is that in the reuniting of the left and right hemispheres of the brain, which become incredibly separated, especially in adult men, we're very much Denzians of one half or the other half of our brains and rarely ever actually occupy them both simultaneously, especially men occupied in sort of technical professions where kind of logical thinking is involved. Essentially the brain is separated into the two hemispheres, the right and left hemisphere. The left hemisphere, generally speaking, is dominant in right-handed men and right-handed people generally, and is generally dominant in rational, logical, deductive activities. And the left brain is generally considered to be our more artistic, creative side of our brain, responsible for, you know, art, poetry, music, etc. The left and right hemispheres tend to be segregated by our separation of the arts and the sciences when we're schooled. We are put in art class, and then we are put in science class, and then we are put in English class, and we don't generally tend to draw on our books when we're in English class. We don't tend to create artworks out of chemistry sets, and so you can see this sort of compartmentalization that is inbuilt into the comprehensive education system. And also into our kind of life choices and the career choices that we make, and the skills and talents that we need to apply to those career choices. Now, the issue with this being is that in the event of, I'm going to use it, traumatic event. This doesn't necessarily have to be a car crash or a death. Or a traumatic event is essentially anything that leaves you bereft. Anything that leaves you feeling unable to go on, I guess. And that can be, you know what I mean, if you're really skint and facing eviction, a big bill can be pretty bloody traumatic if you know that there's no way of you avoiding it. I mean, if you've got your meters on the outside of your house or whatever, and you know that the electric or the gas can just come around and turn you off whenever they like, you know what I mean, that can be a pretty grievous place to be in, especially if you're a parent with children. So, I mean, again, this isn't stuff that is simply limited to people who have already recognised a degree of emotional incapacity or mental disability in themselves, let alone necessarily gone and seen the doctor about it. I mean, Shaziz kindly confessed to having lived a life of secret poor mental health and long spells of depression. And he said that I was probably the first, well, we were the first people that he'd told ever. And that's, you know, I mean, a big admission for somebody of, you know, I mean, of our age. That's a big admission to make to yourself. You know what I mean? This is another thing as well, is that we often don't like to say these things out loud, or which is something I'll be getting onto. Or, you know what I mean, at least, you know what I mean, internally speak them aloud. The that which we dare not call its name. So we've got the two hemispheres of the brain. And when we are in a traumatic situation, certain barriers, certain cognitive barriers are thrown up by the mind in self-defense against the situation. This can be, you know what I mean, if we're witness to a fight breaking out, sometimes you'll find yourself in almost like a frozen moment where you're incapable of moving, you know what I mean, the rabbit in the headlights moment. That can be quite a traumatic experience, because essentially all of your hormones are raging for you to either leap into the fray and to beat the crap out of somebody, or to leg it in the other direction. And in the sort of dichotomy of decisions, the body gets kind of caught up, and the hormones will run rampant, and you'll experience all of the sensations of, you know what I mean, having leapt into the fight or actively running away, but you'll be stuck still on the spot, and that this can be quite a damaging thing. And this is quite important as well, is that if we're in a persistent anxiolic state, if we have a persistent anxiety problems, which was one of my issues, we end up in this state called hypervigilance, which is essentially where the bang of a car door outside will make you jump out of your skin. You home in on every last nuance of what people are saying and try to interpret, you know what I mean, vast swathes of meaning out of the, you know what I mean, the merest coincidental casual conversation. You'll see significance in all sorts of scary ways of things that are out to get you. And again, like I say, when, you know, when our thoughts are our own, our thoughts are our thoughts, and that when we are suffering from less than lucid thinking capacities, then it's very hard to distinguish one's normal thought patterns from these kind of erroneous random error messages that are being thrown up in this kind of fight or flight state. And again, these are all quite normal, natural physiological responses for an animal that would be living the lifestyle that we as prey and hunter-gatherers would have evolved through. And so our physiques, our physical bodies are designed to sustain this incredible outbursts of energy when it's needed. You know what I mean? We've all heard the stories of, you know what I mean, the archetypal stories of the mother lifting the 2-ton car off of the crushed child, when she normally would struggle to carry the bags of shopping in from the same car, you know what I mean, on a coming home on a Saturday. I've experienced it. The warp spasm, the slain-like adrenaline rage, where you can literally I've torn my own muscles in blind rage when, you know what I mean, when it's struck. And this is just, you literally are so flooded with adrenaline that all physical constraints, the fight or flight scenario was developed by the body to respond to imminent death or danger. And so all of, you know what I mean, your hair stops growing, your nails stop growing, your immune system shuts down, your pupils dilate to collate as much light as possible, your hearing becomes much more acute. This is where sort of tinnitus comes from in stress states, that the adrenaline causes tinnitus simply because the ears are turning up their internal amplification, and in the absence of any signal, in the absence of anything to actually hear of any great import, it just turns the signal up a bit more. There must be something out there scary that I've got to listen to. I've got all this adrenaline. Where's that scary thing I need to hear? And if you imagine that kind of exported to all of your physical senses, that's really essentially what we're talking about here with an anxiety state, is varying layers up to, you know what I mean, a full-on panic attack, which will essentially mimic the physical responses of epilepsy in some degrees. It can be that severe. And this is simply just levels, and I think again we're looking at the rate of change of level. So if we're suddenly plunged into a shocking situation and we're in this kind of hypervigilant state, the sudden rush of adrenaline is the dangerous thing. I think that if these things kind of creep up on us slow, we can kind of adjust. It's a bit like the boiling frog in the water, you know what I mean? Not jumping out of the pan if you raise the temperature of the water slowly enough. That our psyches are very much programmed like this to respond to sudden change. And again, this is physically very harmful to the anxiolytic and to the depressive to be in this hypervigilant state for any length of time. It's incredibly draining on the body and can lead to both extremes, really. It can lead to, almost anorexia-like thinness due to the constant repeated demands of your nerves for activity. And this just being incredibly energy hungry, and if you don't, replace that energy, if you don't replenish that nervous energy with food, then the body starts to go into breakdown. Or alternatively, this constant agitation of the nerves informs the body that a threatening situation is imminent, and one will start to load up body fat. So people will often bloat up and put on lots of weight in stressful situations. When you add to this the effects of many of the psychiatric medications on things like appetite and on levels of body fat in different parts of your body, you can see how what somebody may consider to be an eating problem may in fact be absolutely nothing at all to do with the food that they're putting past their teeth, but simply this kind of persistent physiological state that they've found themselves in. So anyway, back to this CBT. I'm hoping to kind of illustrate a model. This is really only a model. This isn't really how the brain works, but this is just simply a way of describing the functions in such a way that we end up with a visual representation, a mental image of what it is that's happening. And if you imagine that all of your kind of right side of your body is hook-wired to the left side of your brain, and all your left side of your body is hook-wired to the right side of your brain, then your brain has got this this kind of bridge in between. It's corpus collecti, I think it's called. I could be completely wrong there. But essentially it's like a small network bridge between the two hemispheres. In fact, there's been some treatment of very severe cases of epilepsy by actually physically severing that part of the brain, so that the right and left hemispheres are actually fully disconnected, and so erroneous signals that could spill over into full temporal lobe epilepsy are essentially maintained in the hemisphere that they spawn from, and can't propagate throughout the brain, leaving the epileptic with at least half a functioning brain with which to be able to remain conscious. And obviously for somebody that's having repetitive temporal lobe epileptic fits and injuring themselves and risking death with each one, this could be a huge surgical intervention, a successful surgical intervention from what I've looked into. It's not the sort of thing that you'd necessarily want to consider, is it? Having somebody stick a scalpel in your brain and cut the bit that connects it together, but that's what they do. But anyway, this collective bridge between the hemispheres is very important, because it atrophies and becomes de-emphasized with this separation out of our artistic sides and our intellectual sides by the driving of the education system, and like I say, the kind of makeup of modern society and our roles in it. And what tends to happen is that we compartmentalize various elements of our life into one hemisphere or the other hemisphere, and so as a consequence, that part of our memory, that part of our active thoughts, is sustained within a half-functioning brain, within only the artistic side, or only within the logical, rational side. And that really, for any thought to be complete, it needs to have been considered and analysed by both halves of the brain. That this is essentially it, that the reason it would appear that our brain is set up almost like a parallel computer, where we put two identical inputs into two completely different computers, but with essentially the same programs running on each, and then compare the output. And it's from the compared output that we get a realistic impression of the world around us. So you can see that in the absence of this comparative analysis of the throughput of our minds, we can end up with a very biased picture. There's no error checking in a one-sided thought, in a one brain, one hemisphere sided thinking. The analysis doesn't get done, so we can logically work on that thought, but the comparative analysis with the other side of the brain is absent from that picture. And as a result, if error does creep in, if what we perceive isn't what's really happening, and like I say, because of this tendency to believe our own thoughts above all else, that when this error creeps in, when this discrepancy between reality and our thoughts creeps in, that this can basically dial back in to the same damage and reinforce that damage with more one-sided brain thinking, and almost create like a log jam on that side of the mind. And suddenly we may find ourselves with our left, with our right logical brain completely overwhelmed by the log jam of unassociated thoughts, of non-error corrected thoughts, of non-hemisynced parallel error checked thoughts. And we can find our logical side being completely corrupted by this, and we become incapable of coherent thought. And so we flit from, we know how to think, we know that we used to be able to think, we know that we still appear to be able to think, but our thinking doesn't work quite. It's a bit like riding a push bike with a wonky cog, that every couple of times around it clunks. It's you can feel that there's something not quite right, but in the absence of a comparison, there's no real way of knowing quite what is wrong. And so often we find ourselves in this, people suffering from, I have found myself in this state, and from discussing these states with other people, I feel that a lot of other people find themselves in these states where they're trapped into a pattern of thinking and of a pattern of behaviour that they don't really understand. They don't really understand where it came from, they don't really understand why it's there, and they don't seem to feel capable of overcoming it. And this is exactly the issue here, right, is that in order to be able to overcome an error-laden right hemisphere, we have to connect it to its component part on the left, and that this is where CBT comes in. Now, if you're in a position of being burdened by emotional outbursts or moods that don't seem to be associated with anything that's happening in the here and now, but aren't necessarily associated with any memories, what I'd advise you to do is, now this is best done longhand, you could sit and do this at the computer because it doesn't matter, writing is writing, but because writing out longhand engages your creative side much more vigorously than simply writing, because you're writing and you're having to imagine the words, imagine the scenarios that you're writing about. This fully engages the artistic creative side of the brain. And essentially write down, to do a full CBT workout, one would write down one's entire life history in as full a detail as one could manage without obviously going to an entire autobiography. And having written out longhand everything that you can remember, every detail that you can remember, every significant thing from your active memory of the past that you can write out longhand on the page. And then, here's the key, you read it back to yourself out loud. And here's the important part, you must read it out loud. You don't have to read it to anybody else. Nobody else needs to hear your innermost thoughts. Okay, you don't need to go to a psychiatrist, you don't need a counsellor, you don't need expensive therapy. Write your life history down, read it back out to yourself. Even better, if you can record yourself reading it back out to yourself, and then listen to that recording afterwards, and you will be absolutely astounded. I mean, I would even recommend this to anybody that has never suffered a blue day in their life, has never even considered themselves to have any sort of emotional or mental instability. That this writing out your life history and reading it out loud, the hemisync just brings unbidden memories, just complete forgotten chunks of your life to vivid, three-dimensional, touch it, taste it, smell it, reality. And for me, it saved my life. I can't express this any stronger. It saved my life. It removed the crushing, overriding, overarching emotional states that I would find myself in, unbidden, unexplained, without any associated active memory that I could refer to. Suddenly, all of these emotional states suddenly had their apportioned, rational, logical explanation. And not only that, but I remembered things about my family and the kind of turmoil that we're in. And there were some really interesting things that came up. I think it was one of the things about my father. And I remember suddenly remembering this incident where he'd shown this huge weakness of character, where he'd always been, you know, I mean, for the few short years that he was living at home with me and my mum, he'd always been this big lorry driving, beer drinking. And I remember this moment of weakness, and this moment of weakness suddenly became the explaining this moment, remembering this moment of weakness in him, suddenly explained for me an entire, you know, I mean, almost the entire explanation of why he'd left my mother, and what had driven him away was suddenly crystallized in just that one small thought about his one moment of weakness. And I can't explain to you how all of that can logically be deduced from such small thoughts. But trust me, this is the incredible power of hemisyncing, of synchronizing your left and right brain hemispheres by writing things down and reading them out aloud, is that there is another layer of decoding, de-impatterning of the emotional landscape of your past life in that moment. And suddenly that decoupling or recoupling of the two components of your life, the logical and the emotional, we suddenly, you know, I mean, find ourselves in perhaps back in a moment in the past, remembering a childhood incident where certainly as a boy I would probably have used logic and reason to explain something that to me as a child would have been inexplicable and misunderstood, and I would completely reject the emotional content of that experience. And so through this hemi-syncing, suddenly the emotional and the logical recollections are reunited, and as a whole suddenly they throw this light of completeness on the complexity of all of these emotional interactions that it had from active memory, from trying to remember them, had given me nothing over a huge length of time. And for me this was particularly pertinent because most of my trauma really ended, by the time I was 6 or 7, and was not really that great deal of trauma on the scale of, you know, I mean, the sort of traumas that people can suffer, but relatively traumatic. But that because my adult life issues had really stemmed from this period, suddenly being able to access these childhood memories that had been excluded by the blockading of the trauma, the wishing not to remember of it all, it unlocked all of that trauma. It was suddenly all out in the light of day, and not only that, but in a new clarity, with a new completeness that it had lacked before. So yeah, very, very powerful tool, and I really do strongly advise anybody just to give it a go, just out of interest. Just get back to me, see what you come up with from that, because I'd be fascinated to know. Right, I'm going to chuck another tune on because my errant child has not subsequently made me a cup of tea, regardless of by shouting at him kindly through the door to do so. I could shout again, but I think I probably need to mute out or deafen you all. Right, so where were we? Cognitive behavioural therapy. I've covered fairly thoroughly the subject of the written word method of hemisyncing, explain that this is a much more powerful reprogramming tool than just something that you can necessarily use as a combatant to, you know, in mental disorder or emotional disability. To add to this, we are told by the scientists that once we are 7 or 8 years old, we have our full pattern of synapses, and that from 7 years old to 21 years old, essentially it's a pairing back process, that the process of childhood essentially delivers unto us many, many more synaptic connections than are necessary for our, our automata-like, our robotic existence. And so as muscle programming, as reflex responses are slowly dialed in and honed to perfection by the child's body in a perfect synaptic map of those physical activities, routings in the brain are established because of the need for conscious control of the child's limbs, and every aspect of the child's life is essentially permanently under conscious control at that age because of the developing child's faculties. And as a result, we end up with this hugely over-complex neural network by the time we're 7 years old, much, much more complex than we would need as adults, or may consider we would need as adults. And so what happens from 7 to 21 is a period of atrophying, where selectively we disregard those unused parts of the brain that are no longer required to coordinate, hand to eye movements once they become automated, once they become dialed in, once they become subconscious. The requirement for the neural pathway that was required to consciously control those actions in the learning process up to 7 years old are no longer needed, and essentially those synaptic paths atrophy, i.e. wither, and are eroded away by the processes of cellular replenishment over the 7 year cycle. Which is actually another key point, that there is a 7 year physical cycle where every cell in your body is more or less replaced once every 7 years. Obviously not all at once, because we'd look pretty shabby every 7 years otherwise. I tend to get pretty shabby most of the time, if the truth be told. The scientists will tell you that from the age of 21, your neural network map is fixed and unalterable. And also any physical damage, any physical severing of any of those neural network paths will be permanent and irreparable. Well, I'm here as standing testament that that patently isn't true, or at least is partially untrue. But essentially the neural paths from, let's say, one's hands to the appropriate part of the brain are very much like the rivulets of a pre-stream runoff of water from a spring down a hill. And essentially the nerve impulse will be received by the receptor at the fingertip, and it will travel the most direct path to its appropriate point in the brain, But if that direct path is obstructed or isn't the quickest path, or isn't running at speed, that nerve signal will pretty much find a way if there is a connection between it and the, a part of the brain. And that what I suspect may happen is that, in fact, if we sever minor nerves around our body, that what would appear to happen is that that nerve will simply find a different neural path from your finger to your head. And initially, what I tend to find is that I've severed a whole bunch of nerves. I've dropped two-ton plates of steel on my fingers. I've caught my fingers in guillotines. I've run them over cars, smashed them with hammers. I've severed quite a few bits and pieces of my hands and lost all sensation in them for a period of time, accordingly. And each time the doctor has assured me that, unfortunately, this loss of sensation is most likely going to be permanent, seeing as our nerves don't regrow. And in each one of these cases, I have returned to full sensation, fully sensate, after a period of about 7 years. Now, the intriguing part about this is that after the initial phase of complete insensitivity, of complete numbness, of a lack of sensation from the affected area, that after about 5 or 6 years, suddenly you'll start to get like stabbing pains from somewhere that's completely insensate, somewhere that you haven't felt anything from for years. And these will often be accompanied by sort of pins and needles, tingling, feeling cold, feeling hot, just a kind of whole, almost like a suite of nerve signals, but without any visible impulse. And after this initial period of sometimes quite painful kind of reactivation of that nerve, what I suspect has happened is that nerve has largely remapped to a new part of the brain, and that this is, again, this dialing in, this kind of honing of the synaptic response to remap that part of the body to a different synaptic path. So what we see, and also to add to this, the study on potential and current London cabbies, which found that during the process of doing what's known as the knowledge, the test that you have to take to become a London cabbie, which is possibly one of the hardest motoring tests on the planet, license tests on the planet, the demands on the hippocampus, which is a postage stamp size part of the brain at the sort of base of your skull, at the back of your head, just below the optical cortex, and the hippocampus is responsible for the orientation in three-dimensional space, the imagining of three-dimensional objects, the mapping of two-dimensional objects into a three-dimensional reality. So essentially for map reading skills, for finding your way, for being able to get from point A to point B without getting lost. Also when working with tools, to predict the effect of, say, an axe blow requires an ability to imagine a three-dimensional event happening from the action of a tool. And in these cabbies, essentially the requirement and the demand of activity on the hippocampus during the period of going through the knowledge and becoming a cabbie is so intense that the hippocampus swells by 400% during the process. So there is a clear filling out, a clear engorging of an individual part of the brain due to a selective stimulus in a very selective way. And so this clearly shows that even as adults, our brains aren't these kind of fixed, like the bloody London tube map, been the same for 20, 30 years. this isn't how it is at all, and that these neural path, these neural pathways are laid down and removed according to how frequently they're used, and that we can retrain our brains. We can retrain our brains, and that one of the most powerful tools that we've got in retraining our brains is the very same facility that was availed to the newborn child up until the age of seven, where the interaction of mind and body created hardwired neural impatterning that essentially, because of our mostly automata-like robotic behaviours, where, you know, I mean, we really do, until you analyse all of your behaviour with a mind to how many actual choices you made and how many of those choices that you thought that you were making were actually predetermined and foregone conclusions. It's quite an interesting self-analysis to do. And what I find is that we are largely creatures of habit, largely automated, that most of our, what we think of as conscious daily activities is very much, I mean, the conscious part of our daily activities is the mere tip of the iceberg, and in fact the busy 90% is in fact going on an entirely unconscious level, facilitated by, hardwired neural systems like the cardiovascular system, where your heart beats without you having to think 120, 121, I'm a bit busy, or I'm quite active now, 136. You know, I mean, that's not how it works, is it? It's in a persistent feedback loop with the entire body to accommodate any of the body's changing metabolic needs. And breathing is actually quite an interesting one. The reason why breathing is such an important tool in things like meditation and overcoming anxiety states is because breathing is one of our primary autonomous body physical responses, in as much as we all breathe most of the time entirely automatically. We don't think breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. And less still do we think breathe in, pause, breathe out, pause, breathe in. And many people, without understanding the importance of the structured breathing and the biofeedback that it has with your synaptic mapping, they can completely miss the point of meditation and exactly what is being achieved through the act of meditation. And that simple act to take a full breath in and pause, and consciously pause. I mean, personally, I'd draw a breath and then hold it consciously until I'm slightly uncomfortable, and then try to breathe out with a controlled out breath, thinking the whole way through the breath, trying to make the breath as even and as smooth and as consistent as possible. On the out breath, I try to breathe out, get to the point where I think my lungs feel empty now, and then know that there will still be a reserve in there, and try to expel that reserve as well, so my lungs are fully emptied, and then pause. And trust me, that pause needs to be a conscious decision, because when you've emptied your lungs completely, your body suddenly goes into almost like a panic state. It's a very emotional sensation. I mean, I suppose it's associated with drowning or suffocation, but essentially the holding of the fully expelled out breath and the holding of the pause consciously, just slightly beyond what one is comfortable with, and then again the applied controlled drawing in of breath, not the sudden gasp of the dying man. You're not dying, you've only paused for 2 or 3 seconds, your body's okay. You know what I mean, this is the conscious application of intention of the conscious mind over the autonomous physical body. And the reason why this is so powerful in meditation, the reason why meditation is so curative, is that this this reinforcing of the mind over the physical is a very important thing when we're suffering from illness, when we're suffering from disability, when we're suffering from mental health or emotional health problems. It's very easy to feel victim to our bodies, to feel a casual observer in the events of our lives. And this simple act of controlling one's breath to such a degree where the body is convinced that there's something bad happening, but you with your conscious mind know that you are imposing that sensation and are embracing it and are using it and are able to resist the urge to descend into breathless panting and gasping for that perceived lack. And trust me, five or six breaths is all you need of that very powerful breathing technique to take you out of a very chronic anxiety state. You know what I mean? If you're going into a panic attack, if you're going into an anxiety state, do five or six full breaths, as full as you can possibly do, fully empty, fully full, controlled. Don't push it till you're gasping. There's no point in that. It's all about control. And you will find that if you can force that intellectual command over your lungs, the response from your mind-body junction will be one of reinforcing your intellectual control over the, you know what I mean, the uncontrollable physical world. And it's an incredibly curative, powerful tool. And you know what I mean, as an anxiolic going into the professional video industry when I was still untreated, uncorrected anxiolic, I would find myself in the most incredibly high pressure work situations where the focus of everybody's eye is upon you in the room, which is never a bloody comfortable place for me. I like to sit in the shadows at the back of me. And your performance is, you know what I mean, is everybody, you know what I mean, is everybody's experience, is your performance in that moment. And I would often, you know what I mean, if things started to go wrong, if my mixer blew up, if something terrible happened, I would find that simply by sitting and forcing myself not to react to the situation at all, but simply to sit and take three or four, if I can spare the time, five, six or seven, preferably not enough to make yourself feel a bit dizzy, you know what I mean, because you're obviously at work, I don't want to be passing out. But within that 3 to 5 breaths, you'll suddenly feel a releasing within yourself, an undoing of that tension. And with that undoing of the tension, you'll probably actually find that the solution to the situation that you're immediately presented with will come unbidden into your head. The missus is always bloody telling me, just put it down and stop doing it for a bit. Because I'm always doing, you know, I'm building fucking crappy old PCs and cobbling together bits of stereo, cobbling together old dodgy bits of motors, and everything's always on the ragged edge and kind of on its last legs and a bit kind of desperate hope. So as a result, I find myself in all sorts of scrapes with various things that I'm trying to fix or get to work. And we do, we get our nose so pressed up against an issue and are so driven to resolve that issue that we don't step away, we don't stop and take that moment to pause, that moment to breathe. And I, of all people, should know the importance of that, should know the power of that, because I make use of it in another scenario where I'm, you know what I mean, in a more professional role and acting a different character. And this is the other thing as well, is we do all have these personas. It's not just a single persona, it's a multiple persona. We are actors on the stage, you know what I mean? We don't present the same self to our work colleagues as we do to our drinking buddies, as we do to our lovers, as we do to our pets, our children. I mean, all of these are different masks to present an acceptable face of the underlying self. I think sometimes we get confused between the complexities of some of those masks that we wear. And confusion of characters. Okay, so I think I'm going to go into synaptic remapping, having now done my best to explain the kind of theory. So back to the plot. Was there a plot? If there was, I must have lost it a long time ago. Synaptic remapping. So I've kind of basically outlined how us rational thinking, wonderful intellectual beings that we think we are actually largely automata in our daily lives, and that a mere fraction of all of our intellectual processes are actually really that intellectual. Most of them are simply control signals running on a repeated learnt program. So, you know, I mean, essentially the cupboards are empty, that triggers a response to go to the bloody shops. You're thirsty, that triggers a response to go and fill the kettle. You're driving the car, a rising pitch from the engine triggers a response to dip the clutch and put it into another gear. All of these we do without actually thinking. We may think that we think about them, but if you actually observe yourself, and the number of occasions that you'll find yourself to have been able to have done all of these things perfectly competently without having the slightest self-awareness of having done them. I give the example of driving back with my son from university recently and doing 90-something miles in the car without being slightly aware of even being in the car, let alone being the driver, doing, you know, in excess of 70 miles an hour for 90 miles in heavy traffic. So essentially, we are these learnt muscle memory automata running subroutines like some insane robot, largely. And that these subroutines are loaded, programs are loaded into the miasmic neural network that makes up the brain and the central nervous system. And the number of potential interconnectedness, the number of potentially interconnected points in the human brain through the synapses is inconceivable. I mean, there's something like 3 trillion synapses in the adult brain. If you can imagine that each one of those synapses could reference every other synapse via one or other of the synaptic pathways, then you have a computing capacity beyond any supercomputer that not only could we dream of, but that we could probably dream of dreaming of. Certainly nothing that we're going to build in the near future. This whole thing about, oh yeah, we're getting close to artificial intelligence. Are we feck? Not happening. Not even close. We're replicating small components of what would appear to be a reasoned response from what's essentially software subroutines, but it's nothing in comparison with the incredible complexity of the human brain allied to the human senses and the human central nervous system. Stick that up your cybernetic pipe and smoke it. So essentially we have the physical body and its interactions with the physical world mapped in this three-dimensional geometric lattice work of the brain synapses, and that each of these pre-programmed responses will be held like a switchboard routing for a telephone call in an old-fashioned telephone exchange. It will be held in the synapses as a reinforced routing. And the way that the synapses achieve this is by increasing, engorging the size, the capacity, and therefore lowering the resistance of the flow of the synaptic responses between the synapses by putting in bigger and smaller pipes. So the more a synaptic route is used, the bigger a pipe it will be given to transmit that synaptic message more effectively. And a route that is used less frequently will be given a gradually smaller and smaller pipe. It's a bit like your front side bus in the computer. It's a bit like having, I mean, faster and slower front side buses fitted to the parts of your internal computer that require greater or lesser computing capacity. Again, one has to remember that the brain is the most oxygen and blood hungry organ in the body, and something like 2/3 of all of the blood throughput is there purely to deliver the fuel to drive this incredible organ of thought at the top of our bloody bodies. So we have this neural remapping where our physical actions are physically mapped, modelled by these synaptic telephone exchanges, and that these telephone exchanges prefer the networks that are used more often. So, you know what I mean, a synaptic pathway that's used more often will be given more and more bandwidth, as it were. And so what we can see here is that in the presence of compulsive behaviour, or of repeated or cyclic behaviour, or self-destructive behaviour, that we can see how the neural map for that can drive that behaviour beyond the intellectual command of the person experiencing that behaviour. So once we have established these hardwired neural networks, that the unhardwiring, the dismantling of that network intellectually can be a very hard thing to do. And it is possible. I was actually talking to a great friend of mine last night about this very subject. It is possible to do, to become so self-aware, and in each moment, that one can be the gatekeeper of one's own thoughts. And if one can become the gatekeeper of one's own thoughts, then one becomes the master of yourself. If you're looking to become sovereign, if you're looking to become freeman, become freeman of yourself first. You must become sovereign unto yourself. I am that I am. And be aware of who it is that you are. And that in this, like I say, this is an intellectual exercise. And again, like I can't stress enough that the brain is an incredibly energy-hungry device. And so in normal day-to-day living, we wouldn't place this much undue stress on an already overworked organ. But if we're facing difficulties, or if we want to accomplish new skills, then becoming entirely present in the moment, becoming the observer of our own lives, is like a muscle that needs to be exercised. We're very automated, and that automation is done for a reason. It's because the world that we inhabit is a very complex world, and we have to decode it at an incredibly rapid rate. And so if we were to get the full bandwidth data of everything, we would be walking around like dazed idiots most of the time. Perhaps some of us already do. So we have these inbuilt filters that can be corrupted and co-opted by traumatic situations, and involved in the establishment of hardwired, pre-programmed physiological responses and emotional component, and that these can be very difficult to overcome intellectually. And so this is where the CBT, the cognitive behavioural therapy, the physical side of CBT comes in, where essentially if we find ourselves, what tends to happen is we will have an erroneous thought, an unpleasant thought, an unbidden thought, and that unbidden thought will trigger an emotional response. That emotional response will trigger a deepening of the mood, a darkening of the mood, which will make the unpleasant emotional response all that much stronger. And before long, we find ourselves in a situation where we want to make ourselves feel better. Yeah, we don't like feeling bad. It hurts. So we try and make that pain go away. And in our attempts to make that pain go away, we will usually act out a pre-patterned behaviour, probably something from our childhood, a coping strategy, some set of actions that we predetermine will a media like that. You know what I mean? Maybe going down the pub, you know what I mean? I don't know, shouting at the dog, going out and driving the car like a lunatic. I don't know, all sorts of things. Compulsively washing one's hands in the case of somebody who suffers from OCD. Now, the secret with the physical version of CBT is that if we become this master of our own thoughts, gatekeeper of our own mind, and observer of passive observer of our own thinking patterns, then if we are able to catch the initiating erroneous thought, the initial painful memory, the initiator in this thought through to action pattern, and if we can catch that, if we can observe it, it's unlikely that in the initial stages you will be able to prevent the emotional component. So expect to feel bad anyway. Right? There's not a great deal I can do about that. That will come with practice. But initially, if you are able to observe the initiating thought, the initiating trigger thought that sets off the emotional cascade that leads to the physical response, you can recognize through the strength and the persistence of the emotional sensation, the onset, the potential onset of the physical response, i.e., I don't know, I've just remembered my dead mum, I really want a drink, I'm probably going to go out and buy myself a drink. Well, you can intercept at that point. And if instead of going out to buy a drink, you recognize that that would be your normal pattern of behavior, and simply invent a different behavior to do. Walk to the park. Take the dog out for a walk. Run up and down the stairs three times. It really doesn't matter. Yeah? You know what I mean? Go and face the corner and sing la la la. It really doesn't matter what you do, as long as you don't do the thing that it is that you normally do. And this is the important thing. Okay, now this sounds really silly. This sounds farcical, perhaps, to be, you know, I mean, talking in these terms about serious things like mental health. But this could save you from suicide if you're in this dark place, right? That if you can recognize the physical component of this neurological network and take an intellectual interceding role in the play of that initiating erroneous thought and its physical consequences, then you basically enter as an intellectual component in what had been a completely automated biofeedback loop. And having interceded in that biofeedback loop, you cut off that return supply to that synaptic pathway. And slowly, and it will be slowly, you will be able to erode those synaptic pathways intellectually, intentionally, discreetly, without anybody having to know about it. This is all internal. This is all becoming your own corridor monitor, you know what I mean? No running in the halls kind of thing. And moreover, this isn't just something that applies to one's mental health. What I've discovered about this becoming the disembodied observer is that this is also entirely involved with your physical health. I no longer suffer from colds, because I've worked out, I discovered, at least for myself, I hope it works for you lot, that the actual thing that gives you the cold is that, oh no, I'm coming down with a cold thought. And that becoming this disembodied observer in my own mind, I was able to observe that thought, try and transit my conscious mind one time, and I kind of caught it in midair. Gotcha! And it went unthought. Kind of, oh no, and I knew what was coming next, and I grabbed that thought before the thought could be thought. I was the hall monitor, you know what I mean, stopping that thought from running in the corridors, and I didn't get a cold. And I've utilised that technique every time I've felt the slightest symptoms of a cold. I've simply acknowledged my immune system's responding to some kind of environmental cue and thanked it very kindly, often out loud, because I think, again, this is important in the CBT model, that saying things out loud that one might ordinarily only say internally is actually a very powerful force in this kind of remapping. capability. And like I say, if one monitors one's mind, one finds that the mind's ability to create the reality that you experience is far more powerful than you could ever have imagined before you start to really take an active part in the creation and the experiencing of that reality, and what and why you create out of that reality from your kind of desire and intent.
Maybe logic was invented by John von Neumann in 1933. Von Neumann is the unappreciated genius of modern science. Scientists appreciate him, but the general public, I don't think, has ever heard of him. He wrote one of the best books on quantum mechanics. He was one of the pioneers of programmable computers. We wouldn't have internet without him. Anyway, maybe logic, one of his major inventions, instead of dividing everything into true and false like Aristotle, which only applies in the abstract. Aristotelian logic only applies if you ignore the sensory, sensual, space-time continuum in which we live. If you take into context we live in a real universe, which we're touching things, bumping into things, kissing things, loving things, hating things, throwing rocks at things, and so on, realize that most of our perceptions are in the maybe mode. They're not yes or no. They're not true or false. They're just maybes. I think maybe logic is probably the greatest invention of the 20th century. Although, of course, von Neumann had a lot of competition. Kozubski offered an infinite-valued logic in which between yes and no, we've got an infinite series of maybes. Anatole Rapoport invented a four-valued logic: true, false, indeterminate, and meaningless. Indeterminate is something which, in principle, we might be able to test someday, but right now we can't. We don't have the technology to test it. Like, how much life is there in the universe? We just don't know. That's indeterminate. Meaningless are propositions that can never be tested because they're defined, so they can't be tested, such as round squares eat red cabbage. First, you got to find a round square before you can even begin to observe its eating habits. And since you can't find a round square, there's no way of ever testing that. Another one is the Catholic doctrine that after a priest pronounces the right formula over a piece of bread, it becomes the body of a Jew who died 2,000 years ago. And since cannibalism is good for you, you should eat the body of the dead Jew and it'll make you feel good. I don't know, Catholics are not particularly fond of Jews. I don't know why they like that one so much, but they like eating him anyway. Everybody else thinks they're just eating bread. They think they're eating a human being. They think they're Hannibal Lecter. We think they're nuts. I don't know. But that's an example of a meaningless statement. It can't be proven or disproven. If they want to think they're cannibals, let them think it. We can't disprove it. We're not going to bother arguing about it. It's meaningless. Like the round squares. 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 Like the round squares.